very good morning from sunny Worcester. It is the second one-day international between England's women and New Zealand. England victorious, first time out at Bristol, 30 runs the margin of that win. They're looking to take a 2-0 lead, which would pretty much get them in the hot seat to seal the series victory pretty quickly. England once again dominating New Zealand as they did for large sections of the T20 series. In that ODI, they just had too much, and New Zealand falling short at the end after England set a decent total, though Heaven Knight said there was the opportunity perhaps for a few more runs. England just had enough to get that victory in the first game. So here we come to the West Midlands, where it is the most glorious early autumn day. The cathedral over to my left is underneath a small patch of cloud, but in the main, blue skies overhead, and we are inside the commentary box, which is a little like a greenhouse today. It is quite warm. Alex Hartley, World Cup winner in 2017, alongside me with your sunnies on. It could be July. We could be on the Costa del Sol.
Honestly, on the way here, I drove through fog, hailstone, rain, get here, and I think I'm getting a tan through this window. It is boiling.
It is. It's a lovely day, and the forecast looks pretty good for most of it as well. I was thinking about this earlier. England's women have been pretty lucky with the rain this year. They've not had many games that have been affected.
No, well, and that's what we want as well. We don't want rain.
We never want rain, and we haven't got any today, which is the good news. Phil Long, our scorer, is alongside us as well. You've managed to open those windows next to us, Phil, which is good news.
Yep, windows open, cap on. You've gone for sunglasses. I forgot mine, so I've gone for a cap. I feel very DJ-like.
Well, Alex,
you've got some spare sunglasses you bought here last time.
I did. I've got some in the car. Would you like me to go and get them?
I think, well, let's see what happens.
They actually make everything brighter.
Maybe we'll give you 15 minutes so we can do this little bit of a chat before the game starts, Alex, and then maybe you can go on that little journey. Right then, the two teams. New Zealand have won the toss and elected to bowl first. Interesting thoughts from Sophie Devine, their captain, at the toss. She talked about it being one of those tosses we'd have liked to have lost. Comfortable with what we've got, and we're going to give it a good crack. We've just got to be better with bat and ball. So a little bit of one of those days where it's quite hard to, as a captain, know what to do. You've come off the back of a defeat, Alex, and you come into a game not quite sure with the conditions how this is going to play. So a tricky one, and in some ways England will be pretty happy, won't they?
Yeah, of course they will. Runs on the board is always a good way to go about things for England, so they'll be happy that they've been put in. It's always the case this time of year when the wickets have been used. It's tired, the outfield's tired, the square's tired. It doesn't actually really matter if you bat or bowl first, and it is what it is, and I suppose you got to do both in the end anyway.
Yeah, indeed, and it's a case of who is going to do it better. And in the last match, it was England who were victorious, getting that win to ensure that they took a 1-0 lead in the series. And it is England that have made the changes in this game. New Zealand unchanged, so they remain with the 11. That is Lauren Downes, Susie Bates, Maddie Green, Amy Satterthwaite, Sophie Devine, the captain, Brooke Halliday, Katie Martin keeps wicket, Hannah Rowe, Jess Kerr, Leah Tahuhu, bowled really well actually at Bristol, and Lee Kasperick. For England, a couple of changes. So Tammy Beaumont and Lauren Winfield Hill will open the batting again. The top five, in fact, top six is exactly the same. Heather Knight is at three, and captains Nat Siver, Amy Jones behind the stumps, Sophia Dunkley, and then in comes Danny Wyatt to play for England for the 200th time in place of Catherine Brunt. Charlie Dean keeps her place after debuting in the last game. Sophie Eccleston, Kate Cross, and Tash Farrant, the other person coming in, she replaces Freya Davis. So the word we've got regarding Catherine Brunt, I think for Farrant and Davis, we can say it's just a straight swap, England squad rotation. In terms of Brunt, though, it's a clear message that we've had from the ECB, and that is that Catherine Brunt will sit out today's game. Her workload is being managed off the back of a busy summer and ahead of three ODIs in 6 days. So no injury, just a case of making sure that she's in top condition.
Yeah, and rightly so. These girls have got a really heavy schedule over the next week. You know, they've got four ODIs to play in 7 days, so Heather Knight came out and said she would rotate her bowlers, and she stuck to her word and given Brunty a little rest.
Yeah, and seeing Catherine Brunt out there, she had a special duty this morning. They were standing in their huddle, and behind her back, hidden, we could see it. Danny Wyatt couldn't, but a special velvet cap to acknowledge 200 internationals for Danielle White. I mean, that's an amazing achievement, isn't it?
That is incredible, isn't it? She's played for a very long time, and what's really good about Wyatt is she's been in and out of this ODI side, and she's stuck around. She's gone back and played regional cricket, scored runs, and she's earned her place back in the England team. But to get to 200 games, it's incredible. I mean, most people don't make it to 50, so let alone 200.
and she'll be in the middle order. She's opened in ODI cricket, she's opened regularly in T20 cricket, one of those players that's floated up and down the order a little bit, but today she's due to bat at 7 before we start seeing the bowling unit. So she really is the sort of like-for-like replacement with Catherine Brunt in terms of the batting lineup, but obviously won't offer, you'd have thought, as many overs with the ball. Let's look back at that first game then, Alex, in Bristol, 3 days ago it is now. Runs for Heather Knight and Tammy Beaumont. Knight 89, Beaumont 44. Brunt actually scored 43, played really well as England put on 241. But there were a number of single-figure scores in there. Sivert, Jones, Dunkley, all out for single-figure scores. So it wasn't the perfect batting performance.
No, it wasn't. They started really well, England, and they built a platform. It looked like they were going to get up to 280, 300, and they just had a batting collapse. I think they lost 4 wickets for 31 runs in that middle order. So that's where they'll be looking to improve. Can our batters get in, get starts, and then carry on? And rather than just, if you face a few dots, getting frustrated and giving your wicket away, there were a few soft dismissals, a couple of unlucky ones, a couple of people got caught down the leg side trying to knock it down to fine leg. So that's one of those things. But what is exciting is England played so well the other day, yet there's so much to improve as well.
Yep, and bowling wise, they'll be looking at this as another opportunity to see what ammunition they got in the ranks. What will have pleased Lisa Kightley and Heather Knight in the last game was that the wickets were shared around. It wasn't one person dominating. Brunt was outstanding in terms of the economy rate. 4 maidens to start her spell of bowling. She took a wicket. Sivert, Cross both got 2, as did Sophie Eccleston, and Freya Davis and Charlie Dean picked up 1 each. So that's the sort of all-round performance that you want to see, isn't it?
Yeah, you want to see that. And Charlie Dean on debut picking up her first international wicket. You know, you want to see all your bowlers contributing and everybody bowled well. You can't just rely on, you know, Sophie Eccleston, Catherine Brunt. You want everyone else to be able to chip in when these players miss out like Brunt is today.
Yeah, and Brunt over there to our right. She's been in the dugout. She's organising the drinks. I think she's just heading upstairs to the England team dressing room in the sunshine in the Graham Hick Pavilion over to our right, which is new and looks very smart indeed. This is a ground that has a lot of sort of idiosyncrasies, as the ladies pavilion over to our right. Next to that, the scoreboard. We're in an old stand with lots of posts holding up the roof, so you sometimes have to just crane your neck around to see exactly where the ball's gone. We've got the cathedral over to our left in the distance, a hotel as well over to our left, where if you're lucky when you do a game here, you can stay at the hotel on the ground. You can overlook the facilities, and you can just tumble out of bed straight onto duty in the commentary box.
Yeah, it's always nice when we play here as well as a regional team as Thunder. If you know, you get a room with a view, you get to wake up to the lovely sights of the groundsman taking the covers off in the morning. I always request a room with a view, but it's only happened once.
Well, there you go. We've got a room with a view today, Alex. We're looking out on the most glorious sea.
Well, it's that hot in this room. My sunglasses keep steaming up.
This is a worrying start to proceedings. The good news is you don't have to worry because you're not doing the first few overs, so you can get yourself settled and we can make sure that everything is working exactly as it should do. So the teams will be out in a moment or two. Danny White, as I mentioned, playing for the 200th time in England colours. For New Zealand, there have been some significant milestones in this series. Susie Bates played her 250th international during the T20s. Sophie Devine, her 100th T20 international. And I reference those two because there is a little bit of a sense that New Zealand have these vastly experienced, high quality players, but perhaps there may just be a little bit of a reliance on them and quite a lot of weight of expectation on those players to do the job.
Yeah, and that's what we've seen throughout this series, just Devine and Satterthwaite actually scoring the runs and doing the bulk of the work. So in this ODI team, they've split them up, you know, Bates opening, Satterthwaite coming in at 4 and Devine at 5. So it's one of those things where they're trying to give somebody else the opportunity to go out there and get the experience of international cricket, score some runs, but they are heavily reliant on those top three players.
Word on Amy Satterthwaite, 79, not out the other day. Looked like she might just be setting her team up for what would have been an amazing victory, but that run out at the end of Lee Kasperic getting England over the line. She played really well, 79 from 87, and that looked like the sort of innings that might be quite sort of inspiring for teammates, just to say, look, you can take your time, you can get in, and you can just make sure that you hang around.
Yeah, it's one of those with cricket. It sounds so simple, but once you've faced 2 or 3 overs and you're in, it becomes so much easier. And we didn't have that from New Zealand in the previous game. They just kept losing consistent wickets. Nobody stuck with Satterthwaite. They were up with the run rate the whole game. They just kept losing consistent wickets. And if somebody had stayed with Amy Satterthwaite, then I genuinely think they could have won.
Yeah, and that is the sort of margins that you're talking about, and whether there is that experience within the New Zealand side to get that job done. This is one of five ODIs at the end of the English summer, and quite a significant block of time that we've got as the side build towards that World Cup defence in March next year in New Zealand. And each game that goes by is another opportunity for experimenting and making sure that you've got the right formulas. But it'll rattle through quite quickly, this series, and England need to find some sort of idea of what their best side is.
Yeah, they do, and it's what a great series to figure that out. You know, you've got a huge opportunity. We're in game two of five now of trying to see what formulas work and what don't. So, like Heather Knight said, she's going to rotate her bowlers. That top six for England is pretty much nailed on. It's glued, you know. It's going to take someone to have horrendous form throughout this series going into the Ashes for them to be dropped. It's just figuring out their bowling formula.
Yeah, and you look at the changes that have been made. Tash Farrant comes in for Freya Davis today, gets an opportunity. She'll be thinking this is a huge chance to impress and maybe seal her place in the thoughts of the coaching staff and the captain. And equally, Danny Wyatt, who's been a little bit of a peripheral figure, knows that if she can get a big score in the middle order, she'll do wonders for her opportunity to be a main part of that World Cup title defence. And of course, the Ashes that goes before it early in the new year. So there is a lot of cricket to come, but it'll go through quite quickly. We don't know what the situation's going to be in terms of England's tour of Pakistan. We'll bring you, of course, that news as soon as we get it. So the amount of cricket left before that tournament is receding, rather.
It is, but England are in a great place. They've played a lot of cricket. You know, going into this series, New Zealand hadn't played since March, April, so they haven't played for a long time. England have played now consistently for a number of years. They always go away in the winter. They're not cricket light.
No, but they will want to, you know, keep that momentum going,
keep
the idea of what that solid top six is, and also get a bit of certainty as to what the rest of them are. I mean, that is where the question marks are.
Yeah, definitely, and now's the opportunity to figure it all out and see what works, see what doesn't. But every time these girls pull an England shirt on and put their cap on and stand at the top of their mark, they know they're playing for their place in that World Cup.
Heading to the middle shortly, I should say, we've got umpire David Mills, familiar figure, in the TV room. Going upstairs, Sue Redfern. And Anna Harris, 22 years old. She's a medical student who plays for Wales. She's been doing Rachel Hayhoe Flint games. She did some games in the Women's 100 as well. And she's coming out to the middle now alongside David Mills to umpire in an international game. It's a really special, important moment for Anna Harris too.
Yeah, and she's a brilliant umpire. She's shown great potential throughout the 100, and I think she's a fantastic umpire. She doesn't often get much wrong, and the best thing about it, she listens to our podcast.
Does she?
She does. She loves it.
Well, don't you, Anna? You love my podcast.
You do love it.
Alex, thank you so much for the time being. Alex Hartley, part of our team today. We'll hear from Isabel Westbury as well. We're going to have a New Zealand voice joining us throughout the day too, which is rather exciting. We've got a little bit of a change to my right. I'm going to get out of the way in a moment and be replaced by Alison Mitchell, and I'm going to do something really mean now to Georgia Elwes, who joins us. And that is, say, Georgia, England international, World Cup winner. You've been in really brilliant form. How brilliant have you been in the last few days? And then Alison Mitchell.
Well, to be honest, it's getting to crunch time in the season. It's just nice to not have to play that extra game on Wednesday, to be honest with you. So, yeah, we got the Southern Vipers through to the Rachel Hayhoe Flint Trophy final next Saturday at Northants. So a big week in store, and as Southern Vipers, we're really looking forward to it.
Hello, Georgia.
Hello.
Good to have you with us. It really is. And hello to you, Phil, as well. And everybody listening, gorgeous sunny day here at Worcester. And yeah, congratulations for getting the side through
Thank you, the final.
And you're playing at Northampton, aren't you? Wantage Road.
Yeah, so it's one of the few county grounds I haven't actually played at yet this in my career. So I'm quite looking forward to that. A bit of a change of scenery. And yeah, very thankful we don't have to play another game on Wednesday.
Gives you a bit of a breather,
doesn't
it?
A bit of a breather, yeah. This old body.
So yeah, the playoff then will take place to determine exactly who you're going to feature, who you're going to play in that final.
Yeah, it's very exciting. I think they're playing that up at Scarborough in the week, so we'll keep a beady eye on that. Got training ourselves on Wednesday, so get us in some good shape, and yeah, be ready for Saturday, whoever we should face.
Very exciting. So, Looking out here at Worcester, gorgeous blue sky, glaring sunshine, but glaring for us in the commentary box here, but the wonderful backdrop of the cathedral beyond the trees at the far end of the ground. And Jessica has the ball in her hand, getting ready to open the bowling to Lauren Winfield-Hill with Tammy Beaumont at the non-strikers end. And they've got a slip in place. And Jessica getting ready to run in now. Right arm, medium pace. She's right arm over into Winfield-Hill, who's driving, but finds extra cover. And so dot ball to start things off. Now, Winfield-Hill in the first match made 21 and was caught down the leg side off Susie Rowe, of Hannah Rowe. But Tammy Beaumont helped put on a really good partnership with Heather Knight that was key to getting England's innings up and running before they had a stutter midway through. Winfield-Hill waits with her bat poised high. And Kerr is in now. She's driving to the same spot, misfield. Still no run, picked up at mid-off by the skipper Sophie Devine, and no run. Toss decision, Georgia, in your experience of this ground and conditions today, what did you make of that for New Zealand to bowl first?
Yeah, I think they're a side that like bowling first, aren't they? They seem to like to get into the game, get everybody out into the middle. I don't think England will be too displeased with that. It looks like a good wicket. They enjoy batting here, and I think they'll be looking to put on a big total.
Kerr comes running in at past the umpire. And now to Winfield-Hill, goes back to turn it into the onside. Isn't quite time it she might have liked, and finds mid-wicket, no runs. The ball is picked up, and it's Brooke Halliday fielding there, sends the ball back into the gloves of the keeper. Yeah, I think New Zealand will certainly want to, they've got a template now. If they're chasing, they've had that experience of chasing in the first game, and they'll know exactly what it is they need to put right.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think you saw in the last game, England's middle order didn't quite fire. So New Zealand may fancy themselves to pull them to a little, keep them to a little total.
Kerr, and again, forward comes Winfield-Hill on the drive once more, but New Zealand keeping things tight in this inner ring. Again, out towards extra cover, and there's no run. Winfield-Hill comes forward out of her ground, a little prod and a poke, and Beaumont comes forward to meet her. When you see your partner advance like that, it's always a bit of a sign thing. Oh, they want a quick word.
Yeah,
come
yeah.
Out the non-striker
just settle the nerves down. Just have a little chat. You're doing great. She looks like she's, even in defence, she's hitting them well. So it's a big day for Lauren Winfield-Hill today, actually.
In goes Kurt. Down the leg side, into the gloves of the keeper, wide signalled. So the first run for England, albeit in the form of an extra. Phil?
Yeah, Georgia just mentioned a big day for Lauren Winfield-Hill. We were discussing this over breakfast. She's looked in good form. Her scores in the last three innings, 42, 36, 21. She's not kicked on. And she'll know it's 5 years now since she scored an ODI 50. So with that World Cup coming up, yep, it's all to play for.
The fact that Danny Wyatt is back in the side today, albeit batting at seven, is an added competition. Forward driving again to extra cover, hits the field. And another dot ball. You're right, the ball's coming off the bat. It's just getting the angles and squeezing it through.
Yeah, it sounds really nice. She's looking good, and she's always a player that looks pretty. She's got great technique, and she enjoys batting here, actually. I remember her batting, that she had a fantastic partnership with Tammy Beaumont here against Pakistan. And I think that was her first ODI 100. So she'll have fond memories of batting here, but she'll know in the back of her mind, you know, she'll be desperate to make a score and to contribute to the team.
Last ball of the over as Kerr is in now to Winfield-Hill. Forward defence thinks of a drop and run, but thinks better of it because, again, New Zealand's swarming, coming forward and very active in the field. So New Zealand and Kerr start with, well, not quite a maiden, the one extra coming from it, but no runs off the bat as yet for England. But it is a 50-over game. It's not quite the T20, certainly not the 100, where you think, yeah, you've absolutely got to get going from over number one.
Yeah, tidy start there from New Zealand, but England will be fairly pleased with that. I think Lauren Winfield-Hill didn't really look troubled in that over. Didn't manage to pierce the field, but nothing looked particularly threatening. And I think it's always difficult when you're trying to transition from one form of cricket to the other and get your head around, you know, not having to go from ball one and attack all the time. But these two have played so much 50 over cricket, and I think they're going to bat well together. They've come through university ranks together. They enjoy each other's company, and I think that plays a big part when you're out in the middle and you're feeling that bit of pressure. If you've got somebody at the other end who you really enjoy batting with and you enjoy their company, that really helps settle the nerves.
Are they part of the Loughborough crew?
Yeah, that's right, well. Yeah. The mighty Loughborough crew.
Now, two slips here. Sophie Devine is preparing to bowl to Beaumont. So Beaumont on strike for the first time here, over number two. And Devine is in forward now. That has pierced the field all the way to the boundary for four. A wonderful drive first up from Beaumont. Now that is the way to get off the mark.
Oh, that is a superb shot. That she's just lent on that. It's pure timing, and what a lovely way to get off the mark, like you said. What a lovely ball to face first up. You want bat on ball as an opener. You want to feel your way into the game, and that will make her feel very good about herself.
So as I mentioned, the two slips. Got a backward point, extra cover mid-off. Goes for a similar stroke, but a little squarer that time. Hits the fielder on the edge of the circle at cover, and there's no run.
Yeah, we mentioned Lauren Winfield Hill a minute ago. Tammy Beaumont, no such problems. She's averaging 83 from her last 10 appearances for England in ODIs.
Yeah, she's been absolutely dominant, hasn't she?
Yeah, wow, she makes it look very easy as well, doesn't she?
Timing, the confidence at the crease. Devine in once more, down the leg side, wide signalled. Now Devine did struggle a little bit in her opening overs in the first game as well, didn't she? Just getting that line right.
Yeah, I think the swing bowlers have found it quite difficult because not always sure about how much it's going to swing, and she's trying to give it a chance there. You can see what she's trying to do, but she's probably asking the ball to do a little bit too much, and it carries on down the leg side.
Blonde-haired Devine at the end of her mark. Decent crowd populating those stands at the Diglis end of the ground. Off the pads this time. Vacant region at square leg, and that'll be four more for Beaumont.
Oh, that's a lovely shot. Touch. Yeah, a lovely bit of timing from Tammy. Flicked off her pads, getting Devine strain onto that leg stump. Trying to look for a little bit too much swing, I think, and Tammy doesn't miss out there.
Well, a very productive over so far with the two boundaries coming from it. The one glorious drive through the extra cover region. And that one is to clip off the pads. Fine leg is back, but there's no way that that was going to be cut off. Devine is in again. Forward comes Beaumont, stroking it up towards mid-on. It's cut off by mid-wicket, moving across to her left-hand side and getting down nice and low. Brooke Halliday making sure she fielded that ball cleanly. I mentioned Danny Wyatt being in the side. Now, did you take part in the cap presentation earlier?
Yeah, it was a great honour. I was asked last night by Heather Knight if I would present a 200th cap for England today, and what an achievement that is for her.
Devine to Beaumont, a full toss. It's been cracked away through the covers for four more. Well, this over for New Zealand has certainly lost the control that we saw from Jess Kerr. Three boundaries off it, all off the bat of Beaumont.
Yeah, and Devine won't be happy with this. She's just looped up a nice full toss, and Tammy has latched onto that. Who won't miss out there?
Yeah, power play overs, the field up. Of course, she absolutely found the gap and hit it so hard as well. There's no way it was going to be cut off. We'll come back to Danny White in a moment as Devine in once more. Oh, been bowled! She's left one. Took a huge stride forward, and that has just come back and taken the off stump.
My goodness, that is not what you expect. A big lead from Tammy Beaumont. She has not expected that ball to cut in as it has. Sophie Devine usually swinging the ball away. Seems like a very strange piece of cricket, to be honest with you.
It's just, I think, moved off the pitch. An extraordinary way for that over to turn out like that, because we've just seen some ill-disciplined bowling, three boundaries, and then she's been bowled, leading one.
Completely against the run of play, wasn't it? It was, you know, Devine normally gets the outswing. That's what Tammy Beaumont was expecting, and actually as the ball came down through the air, it looked like it was the outswinger, so that's why she's gone to leave it, and just off the pitch it's cut back in. Lovely piece of bowling. One of those, as a bowler, you're not quite sure whether you mean it or not, but I'm sure when she walks off the pitch she'll say, oh yeah, I definitely meant that one.
Well, England are 14 for one. The in-form star opener Tammy Beaumont is on her way, so albeit a surprise and something of a shock wicket.
Yeah, you mentioned that over was a mixed bag, wasn't it? Four dot wide, four dot, four out.
Extraordinary. There's the last ball of the over as well. So out comes the captain, Heather Knight. And suddenly, well, Winfield Hill, who didn't score a run off the bat, we just feel a different kind of pressure now that a wicket has suddenly fallen at the other end.
Yeah, I think so. I think she'll be very keen to get off the mark, and hopefully she can do that this over. If she gets a little stray onto the leg stump and she can clip it off her legs, that'd be nice.
It's Kerr in again to Winfield Hill, who comes forward and defends, eases it back up the pitch into the hands of the bowler. So if you think with Danny White and in this side, she's batting at seven. But would Wyatt be seeing this as an opportunity if she can impress? Would she want to be at the top of the order in ODI cricket?
Yeah, I think so. I think she enjoys the freedom of opening the bat in. You've only got the two fielders out. The way she plays really aggressively, she can go after the bowlers and attack and get lots of boundaries, which she likes.
Winfield Hill waits and Kerr is in forward, defending once again into the offside, and Bates moves in at that short extra cover and no run once more. So she didn't feature in the games against India, but of course did play against New Zealand. So the last ODI for Danny Wyatt coming back in February.
Yeah, and she's she had a lean run of form, and I think, you know, Lisa Kiteley said to her, just go back and play for the Southern Vipers and score some runs. And, you know, she did that in abundance, and she had a fantastic 100, and she is in really good form at the moment.
Kerr in now, forward into the onside. This time it's half stopped. It's a shortish mid-wicket region and fielded ultimately at mid-on, and there's no run. And do you feel that's also then where the domestic structure now just means that, I mean, yes, cricket was always played in that domestic fashion, but just the standard of it is just that much more sort of pointed, that she runs in that format almost sort of carrying more weight than
they did
before.
definitely the standard of that competition is skyrocketed this year, and scoring runs in that is almost worth more than it had been in previous years in other domestic competitions. So she'll know, she's been playing in good teams and in front of big crowds in the 100 and under that same sort of pressure, so that would have done her the world of good.
Keep her standing up here as Kerr is in, more of a flourish to the bat this time, but finds point. Throw comes back into the keeper and no run. Yeah, it just gives more of a true barometer as to where a player is at now in the domestic.
Yeah, no, it does, definitely. And I think the way she's gone about scoring her runs as well, she had to find a way at times. And I think all great players come through periods of bad form. And the way she's playing now is certainly back to her best and her fluency that we enjoy when we watch Danny Wyatt.
Kerr, leap at the crease, into Winfield Hill, looking to drive, hasn't quite timed it, finds mid-off, and no run. So dot balls, had six for Winfield Hill in the first over and five now, so still yet to score. New Zealand are keeping that pressure on. We saw the value of maidens, didn't we, from Catherine Brunt
in
the
start of
New Zealand's run chase last game. Gorgeous, warm, sunny day. I can feel the warmth coming in through the window here now. It was a little chillier first thing on arrival at the ground. Kerr into Winfield Hill, eases that behind square on the offside to get off the mark. Opened the face, able to take the single, so rotates the strike, takes a single off the last ball of the over. Three gone, England 15 for one.
Yeah, that was a really lovely play by Lauren Winfield Hill. Then she'll have been feeling the pressure. I was feeling the pressure for her that over. You could sense that something was going to happen. She's just managed to run it down to third man and get off the mark, and I think that'll make her feel better. Sometimes when you're facing and you're under that sort of pressure, you're thinking, crikey, where's my next run going to come from? But you get one away and all of a sudden batting's quite easy again. But she'll be on strike now to face his next divine over.
And when it came to Danny Wyatt's cap, well, first we'll describe the cap. Was it one of those special caps
almost like the baggy blue with some gold trim on it.
Is it velvet?
Velvet, yeah, very with nice. A nice tassel out the top.
And I presume you were asked to say some words.
Yeah, it was asked to do a little speech. Couldn't actually hand over the cap, of course, because of COVID.
Slipping a gully here as Divine is in and Winfield Hill is defending into the offside, no run. So what did you say? Can you recall?
Yeah, so me and Danny have been playing cricket together for 20 years now. She's one of my oldest friends, oldest teammates. And it's nice, actually. It was really nice to be asked. And I just, you know, spoke about the journey that she'd been on and where she'd come from as a little 10-year-old at Staffordshire.
Divine in again. Winfield Hill down the ground, but fielded by mid-off. Another dot ball.
Yeah, I think Danny White's such a unique person. She's a great person to have around the dressing room. She doesn't take life too seriously. She's always having a bit of a laugh and a joke, and quite openly, she's one of those people that you go and talk to if you're not feeling in a very good mood, because she's always got something there to cheer you up. So she's a great human being.
Divine into Winfield Hill, fuller delivery. So bat to it, but only as far as Bates extra cover, and again no run. So she genuinely, do you think she hasn't changed as such as a person? She's the same sort of character as she was as that 10-year-old in the Staffordshire.
Yeah, she's absolutely brilliant. A real lover of life. She loves playing her cricket, and she loves playing cricket in a certain way. And I think that's the beauty of Danny. Whatever number she's been asked to bat, she's played the same way.
Devine, and Winfred Hill forwards. Looked to flick it through the leg side, but it's gone down the leg side. She missed. A wider signal, though, taken by Katie Martin. So that's another extra to England. 16 for one in this fourth over. But the pressure is growing on Winfield Hill here with these dot balls racking up, just looking for one release shot if she can. So how did Wyatt, how did Danny react?
Oh, she was like, I'm so glad it was you who did it. Bless her, she's a sweetheart.
It is those relationships you build over such a long period of time. Winfield Hill up and over the top of point, and she finds the boundary for four. She did need that release shot.
Yes.
That's not without its element of risk attached.
Yeah, I think the bowler was interested for a second then. It was in the air for quite a long time, wasn't it? But just in the gap between cover and point, and yeah, that'll make her feel better. I feel like Devine has bowled a little bit fuller this over, really trying to target Winfield Hill's pads, as teams often think that they can get her out LBW, but that one, a little bit too much width, and she was able to get her hands through it.
Yeah, it flew away. It wasn't a lofted drive, it was more off the outside edge, and this is more of a drive. Now she's laced that through extra cover for four more. Back-to-back boundaries all of a sudden for Winfield Hill.
Yeah, that is a beautiful shot, and that really will settle her down. It's come off the bat, sounds beautiful, and Devine just a little bit too full here. Trying to get the ball to swing, but without much success.
Got one more ball here, Devine, in this over. So slip in the gully, point cover, extra cover, mid off and mid on, a mid wicket and a fine leg. And Devine, the New Zealand captain, is in now, and Winfield Hill leaves this, a shouldering of arms outside the off stump, which might have carried a bit of risk to that given what happened to Beaumont. Exactly the same ball, last ball of the over in the previous. So, but it's the end of four overs. New Zealand winning the toss today and putting England into bat. We have them 24 for one then after four overs. And it was Tammy Beaumont who was bowled by Devine for just 12 at the end of that second over.
Now, I was lucky enough to have breakfast with you two this morning.
You were, yes.
We discussed getting to the ground, and you both said, we'll drive in because the weather looks a bit iffy. And it's like a greenhouse in here, isn't it? Well, I'm never going to trust your weather forecasting again.
Well, we both looked at weather apps, and mine had equally said that there might be a few spots towards the end of the day, and thought, well, you know, I don't want to be walking home in the rain.
So it's a glorious day, isn't it?
I suspect you got here before I did, Georgia. I got stuck in the car park yesterday.
Oh, no.
It's a recurring theme with multi-story car parks and barriers, and, you know, I even had the right tickets. You know, the reception had said put in ticket number one, follow it with ticket number two, but barrier still said no. Kerr in now. And this has been turned off the legs. Behind square, fielded in the deep, and Heather Knight, the England captain, is off the mark with a single.
Yeah, reversing in a multi-storey car park is a skill, and you pulled it off. It was amazing.
Well, I had to negotiate. I think almost a 90-degree turn, didn't I, in reverse? Well, I had to make sure that the cars that were waiting behind me, because inevitably a queue builds up, doesn't it? You're the one at the front.
Of
the barrier
course.
Won't open. They can see you, like, pressing buttons, asking for assistance. Kerr in now. Winfield Hill chips it up in the air. Hasn't quite reached short extra cover. Maybe that's a bump ball, actually, off the bat.
And then, of course, you did reverse, and it was the old age question then. Where's my ticket?
Because in between putting the ticket in and it having spat itself out, I had managed to sort of drop it back between the seat and the door. So, of course, I was looking around me going, well, how have I lost it between trying to get out and now reversing? 25 for one. Fifth over as Kerr is in. Going back and cutting. There's some protection on that deep backward point boundary. It's a single. Winfield Hill gets down the other end as the throw comes back into the gloves of the keeper. So I presume you had no trouble getting out of the car.
No, I was like, did you
paid for your
ticket? Yeah, I was going to say, did you go to the ticket machine?
That did seem to be the ultimate issue in the end, that I hadn't actually paid for it. But I just thought it all went through the hotel.
But yeah, that would be nice, wouldn't it? Free car park.
I just thought it would be added to the bill. Long blonde hair in now. Forward comes Knight. Solid defence up towards mid off, and there's no run. So we got here though, but it is glorious. Some warmth in that sunshine. People in the green bucket seats immediately below us have got sun hats on. And here, is this a hat or is it an actual umbrella? There's a turquoise umbrella, and I can't tell whether it's actually being held above the lady's head or whether it is actually part of a hat.
Well, that'd be great, that.
In goes Kerr to Knight, defending. Ball of a good length on off stump. the offside and no run. I think it is an umbrella. It's too big to be part of the hat.
Yeah.
If that's a hat, that's, you know, you're going to be a bit off balance with
that. I haven't
that.
Seen an umbrella hat at a cricket game before, to be honest.
We were talking about them, actually, the game in Bristol. That's having a... I think it was Alex Hartley saying she was going to get herself an umbrella
hat. Of course,
hat.
If there was anybody in this commentary box, it would be her.
Needed today for the sun, thankfully not the rain. Kurt, in again to Knight, off the outside edge. Well, this one, I've just guided that and opened the face, down towards very fine third. It's just a single, though, because Rowe has made some good ground from her position at deep backward point to field. Single off the last ball of the over then, so five gone, and England are 27 for one, having lost Tammy Beaumont. So good start, albeit a mixed over from Sophie Devine that resulted in the wicket, but they've got rid of Beaumont nonetheless. A few more words from Georgia Elwis, and then Henry Moran is coming in.
Yeah, it has been a bit of a mixed start here for New Zealand. Jess Kerr's bowled really tidily, and she just hasn't had the control from Sophie Devine at the other end that New Zealand would have wanted. And obviously got the wicket of Tammy Beaumont, which is a big wicket for New Zealand, but I think they'll be looking to tidy up here. They just need to build some pressure from the other end, and they're going to do that by bringing Leah Tahuhu into the attack, who was fantastic in the game down at... Bristol. She bowled first change, which isn't usual for her. She normally opens the bowling for New Zealand, but she bowled really well and sort of blasted through England's middle order.
She did. She picked up 2 for 32, but it was that economy rate across those 10 overs, 3.2. Did really well. She's running in from the Diglis end in the sunshine to the right-handed England captain, Heather Knight, who plays the ball towards Satterthwaite at backward point, and there is no run. The score remains 27 for one. Phil Long.
Yeah, those first two Sophie Devine overs, there was the wicket, but five fours and 22 runs coming off those two overs.
Well, madness. It was all going on. I'm worried. We need to get that blind a bit lower for you, Georgia.
Yeah, well, I need my sunglasses on, actually. But,
yeah, are they knocking around?
Yeah, they're in the bottom of my bag.
Here comes the next delivery. Very full on the pads, clipped away out towards deep backward square where Hannah Rowe fields in front of the hotel. And Knight picks up a run, her third. 28 for one is the England score. It is the most glorious day.
It's lovely, isn't it? Oh. September weather.
It really... Phil's been at a wedding this weekend.
Lovely.
Down in Brighton.
Yeah, they decided to hold it outside for sort of COVID reasons. And I think it was fingers crossed, obviously, a September wedding. And then it was actually too hot.
In comes Tahuhu. Right arm over. Drops in a little shorter. Played into the offside. And that's good running between Winfield Hill and Knight. Another run onto the total. 29 for one.
Yeah, congratulations to John and Jess, who got married yesterday. And also at that wedding, in one of those weird coincidences, was one Daniel Norcross.
Was he now?
Yeah. So I met John, who got married out in India. And it turns out Daniel's a long-lost relative of John, a third cousin, four times removed, something like that. And he made it onto the wedding list.
Well, how big was the wedding? In comes Tahuhu bowling to Heather Knight. It's defended back to the bowler.
Yeah, maybe not quite that distant, but they are related in some way. I'm not exactly quite sure how.
I mean, I like Daniel, but I mean, if there was an excuse not to invite him, I wouldn't necessarily.
I think he would admit he dominates a table at a wedding.
A table?
Mm, yeah.
I'm surprised the vicar got a word in edgeways. We're gathered here to, and another thing. 29 for one, in comes the Tahuhu. Bowling to Knight, clipped into the leg side and stopped at mid-wicket.
Yeah, I had to leave early to get the train from Brighton into London and then arrive in Worcester late last night. As I was leaving, I heard him say something along the lines of, well, you know, Titch Freeman is...
Oh.
Dot, dot, dot. And I thought that's maybe a good time to leave.
Yeah, it's when he starts sort of talking about the wicket-keeping qualities of Betty Snowball and, amongst all sorts of other things in the long distant past. 29 for one is the score. A good ball beats the outside edge of Knight's bat, lunging forward, and the over comes to an end with the score on 29 for one. Six overs gone. Lauren Winfield Hill is on 11. Heather Knight is on 3. And I was a little nervous looking at the fixtures early on in the year, thinking that September, you never know, because last year at Derby was pretty chilly for those West Indies games.
Yeah, it was, wasn't it? It was not the weather that the West Indies would have been expecting as they came over, and I think the five jumpers on match day was an indication that it really wasn't cricket weather. But thankfully here, Worcester's turned it on for us, hasn't it?
Yeah.
beautiful.
Yeah, and we mentioned it the other day. This is the latest England women have ever played ODIs in this country. So, yeah, we've got very lucky.
I also found it's the first time England have played New Zealand at Worcester, apparently. Jess Kerr's going to bowl from the new road end of the ground. Right arm over. The keeper standing up and deep in the crease. Winfield Hill plays the ball back to Kerr. And there is no run. It's a ground that doesn't have floodlights, so you don't tend to get the T20s, which happen normally in the evenings. So it is very much the venue that is used for the ODI matches that start at 11 o'clock, particularly at weekends across the summer. Kerr is running in again, bustling past the umpire, and there's a big swing without maximum connection out towards the fielder at fine leg. One taken, 30 for one.
Yeah, as you mentioned, yeah, New Zealand have never played here. England have played here six times before. They've got a record of 1-2, lost four. One of those wins was the score against Pakistan, 378 for five off 50 overs. Hundreds for Beaumont and Winfield, and then 80 off 33 balls from Nat Siver.
I remember that sight screen in the distance took a bit of a hammering. Kerr coming into bowl to Knight, who plays that nicely. It's going to run quite fine down towards deep third, and I think has been brilliantly saved, has it?
Yeah, I think so. I think that's a brilliant bit of fielding if she has managed to pull that back. Hannah Rowe down there running around from this strange wide third man that New Zealand like to have in the game, and I think it has. I think that's a brilliant stop by her.
The electronic boards behind her said four.
Yeah.
And now the umpire's just checking to see if that is the case. Here
we'll
have a look now.
And there's the replay. Oh, I think she might just be. Well, it's going to be one of those. We could be here quite some time. She does a reasonably accurate impression of a seal as she sort of squirms towards the boundary edge. There's a sort of shuffle.
I'm changing my mind. I think that's four.
This is like, it's like yesterday when we were at finals day and Chris Wokes, who was part of our team.
I was listening.
I said, Wokesy, what do you reckon the score is going to be? He said, I reckon it could be about 165. It might be a few more. It might be a few less. So, Chris.
Sitting on the fence,
yeah. Come on. Yeah, he was spot on.
Yeah. I think in the end it was 168, so fair play to him. But, yeah, we look at another replay. I mean, it's one of those where surely the fielder knows.
Yeah, but you're not going to tell them, are you, if it's four? You leave it to the umpires upstairs.
Well, it's umpire Sue Redfern that's at the controls upstairs. And we watch again as Hannah Rowe, legs in the air, slides forward. And we aren't going to learn any more from this replay, Georgia. It's the same thing we've seen for the last 30 seconds, and we still don't know. Right.
Who'd be an umpire making these decisions?
So, sliding forward, hand on the ball, get on with it, someone shouts down in front of us. And after all of that,
I suppose it's whether the ball's in contact with her body there, isn't it, as she hits the rope, or my eyes aren't good enough to see from here.
No, nor my Phil.
Well, as you mentioned earlier, we've not got floodlights, so we need to get a move on here, don't we, really?
Imagine it's going to be mid-November. Can we rock and roll it? It's four. There we go. Lovely. Well, the person controlling the screen said it was four immediately. We should just listen to them. It's going to be Kerr again. 34 for one. Knight moves to seven, her first boundary. As the next ball is into the leg side. Behind square, a single is taken. And England move to 35 for one. When you're out in the middle, something like that, are you just like, oh, can we just all get on with it?
Yeah. Oh, 100%, yeah. Absolutely. As you said, the fielder generally knows, so it's normally give a little soft signal and you think, come on, next ball.
We've all got places to go. 35 for one. Here comes Kerr. Moving in past the umpire. Winfield Hill is defending. There's a little half appeal for an LBW. And the score remains on 35 for one. Is Alison Mitchell around? She is. Ali, I've just been sent a message from the ECB. We've got lunch orders. Do you want the chicken, the cod, or the tofu? Chicken, right, lovely. I've asked everyone else, but you were on air at the time. Now I'm on air, and I was going to wait till you came off, and that has just not worked in the slightest. Right, next delivery is driven nicely. Good piece of timing, but it stopped at short extra cover by Susie Bates. And the score remains at 35-1 at the conclusion of the seventh over.
Yeah, you showed me that message, and I thought it was going to be, you know, this is so-and-so's, the stat I'd missed, and yeah, it was... I think I went for chicken, didn't I?
I get this with Christmas parties. Like,
no, I did go for chicken. I did go for chicken.
You did go for chicken. Yep. We've got... You've gone cod.
Yes, cod. Yeah. It's something a bit different.
Go.
I don't know if I saw cod.
Oh.
No, too late now, Phil. You've made your choice. Stick with it. Sorry, I know, you know, that is the sort of thing that... really should be left to offer, but I got a message saying we need to know ASAP. So England 36-1. This feels like quite a well balanced start, really. England going at a decent rate, but that big breakthrough will change things. Here comes Lear Tahuhu and the long sleeves from the far end of the ground, and that's nicely played away through the offside. Good piece of timing from Winfield Hill. It goes in front of square, fielders in pursuit, and it will just be hauled in by Susie Bates, who flips the ball back in a relay. Alongside Lee Kasperick, and England get a couple of runs. In fact, did they get three there?
Yeah,
three.
It was a really good bit of running there. So as she flicked the ball back, it actually missed the fielder who was following her, so England pinched a third.
39-1 then, the England score. Winfield Hill is on to 16. And Tammy Beaumont, a rare failure from Tammy Beaumont. It was a weird dismissal.
It was a weird dismissal. It was a bit of... a mind blank maybe from her.
Yeah, it felt that way. Here comes Tahuhu bowling to Knight, very firmly forward. Lovely. That's shot. A lovely shot. Good piece of timing, back past the bowler. It's running up towards the boundary, slows a little bit, and is collected out there in the distance by Sophie Devine as England pick up two more, so the score moves to 41-1.
Very quick, niche and irrelevant stat.
I like these.
That was the first three of the series.
Is it the first three of the summer?
No, I think we had a few one of the India games. We had quite a few, actually. But the game the other day, no threes and no sixes.
Oh, in the last game?
In the last game, yeah.
Is that right? Mm. Tahuhu at the end of her mark. We've got a slip in place in the form of Maddie Green. There's fielders in the deep. We're still in the power play. We've got 2.4 overs of that left. As Knight defends into the offside. Yeah, fielders in the deep at deep third just in front of us. And then also deep backwards square leg. There's a good crowd in as well, enjoying the sunshine. Plenty of wide-brimmed hats. That sort of day. Well, you need protection from the sun. It's sort of day my mum would say. Don't forget, maybe September, but still put the sun cream. You know what I mean?
Definitely.
In comes Tahuhu, bowling to Knight, played into the ground, well stopped by Satterthwaite fielding behind square on the offside. And some wispy clouds overhead, but bright sunshine. And I was a bit worried driving down from Birmingham this morning because there was a little bit of rain in the air, and you just sort of... mid-September. But it's always like this in the West Midlands, isn't it?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. And then you don't know which way it's going to turn. But thankfully, today, it's perfect ice cream weather, isn't it?
Apparently, there's not an ice cream
van. Oh, no.
Apparently.
Oh, no.
Our scouts have been out. Tahuhu bowls a quick delivery, which sees Knight pulling into the leg side. Nice bit of timing and picks up four. Really good work from the England skipper. He was onto it quickly because Tahuhu, one of the quicker bowlers in the women's game, dug it in short. Was pulled away mightily by the England captain. 45-1.
Yeah, I think that's the benefit of this crop of England players grew up playing boys cricket, so they're not afraid of a little bit of pace. Actually, you think you ask a few of them, they actually prefer it. So Heather Knight, one of those, and very quickly onto the short ball, and she wasn't going to miss out there.
Tahuhu moving in again. And bowls another quick delivery, which sees Knight pushing into the offside. It's quite an interesting point this as the over comes to an end. 8 gone, 45-1. I was discussing this with a test match special fellow scorer, Andy Zaltzman, yesterday, which is there anyone in the women's game? You're about to go, actually, so I'm going to leave you to ponder this. I'm going to ask this to Alex Hartley, who's about to join us. And the question is this. Thank you, Georgia Elwes, very much indeed for joining us. You've been in brilliant form for the Southern Vipers in the last couple of games. An unbeaten 100, an unbeaten 80-odd yesterday. It's lovely to have you as part of the team. And Alex Hartley joins us once again, who were in action for the Northwest Thunder yesterday. But Alex, the question that Andy poses, in the women's game, actually pace on the ball can be quite a positive thing because players can score really quickly. And is there any, will you ever get to the point where somebody is so quick that actually they trouble anyone? And in some ways you won't get rewarded for bowling at 80 miles an hour because the players will be good enough to play it, and you're not going to get someone that's going to bowl at 90.
I think if you look at, if you watch Elise Perry bowl, she still beats the outside edge and troubles players. So there is, you know, you have someone that bowls 80 mile an hour, they're going to trouble players the same way as Elise Perry does. You know, Shamim Ishmael bowls quick, she troubles the outside edge, and it's all relative, isn't it? So if you bowl quick, you're going to challenge batters in different ways.
Indeed. I think that's a good point. Now, you know, you look at someone like Shamim Ishmael, she does do that. She does cause real problems. Here comes Jessica. It's on the pads of Winfield Hill, and it's gone down the leg side. And I wonder if there's any bat involved in that, or if it's no, it's gone straight through. It's wide. So five onto the total to bring the 50 up for England as it whistles down to the boundary. An errant line from Jessica. Keep her up to the stumps. Nothing can be done.
There's a pole in my way. I'm going to have to just shuffle.
You know, I was going to say, there was a pole in your way. It's going to be there permanently.
I'm just going to shuffle to the side.
If the things that can move in this situation, Alex, you're the only one that can. 50 for one. Jessica bowling. That's nicely clipped away into the leg side. And we'll bring another run from the bat of Lauren Winfield Hill, who moves 217, England 51 for one. What have you made of this start?
Yeah, it's been a decent start for England, hasn't it? Apart from Tammy Beaumont's brain fart, leaving the ball and getting bowled, which happens very rarely, but, you know, it does happen. It's been a positive start, and what's good to see is the ball is racing to the boundary as well when it's hit off the square.
Kerr moving in again to bowl to Heather Knight, looking for the angle on the leg side. Can't find the gap past Brooke Halliday inside the circle, so there won't be a run there.
I always like it at this ground because it's a ground that we played in 2016, England versus Pakistan, and Heather Knight and Nat Siver absolutely smacked it.
Yeah, we were just speaking about it. I think Nat Siver's 80 was 80 or 30 odd ball. Yeah. Ridiculous.
It's one of the best things I've ever seen.
In comes Kerr to bowl tonight, who gets a little bit cramped for room. There's a peel for LBW, but it looked, I mean, our view is not straight on, but it looked high from here. Phil Long, you're looking poised.
No, we forgot to mention from talking about that game that batting at number three that day was one Georgia Elwis. So apologies, Georgia, we didn't mention your 17 off 15 balls as England made 378 for five.
That was a great day. I remember having my bib on, mixing the drinks, saying, if playing for England is like this every time, I'll run the drinks for the rest of my career.
In comes Kerr to bowl to Knight, who defends very properly back to the bowler, straight delivery.
Yeah, and then we mentioned it earlier, in terms of today's game, Winfield Hill made 100 that day. It's the only 100 she's made for England, and she's now 23 games without a 50. So great chance today to remedy that.
That's quite a long way.
That is quite a long way. I think she's had a bit of a tough time since the 2017 World Cup and when she broke her wrist. So she'll be wanting to prove a point.
Kerr, bowling. That's nicely driven, but straight to the hands of the fielder. No, it's gone right through. I thought for a moment that it had gone straight to that fielder, but it's managed to pierce the gap on the offside and bring four runs. So nicely struck from Knight. And England move that scoreboard along. Now stands at 55 for one with the ball left of the ninth over.
Well, what a cover drive that is from Heather Knight. She just leans into the ball, head over her front pad, and it did go to that fielder and went straight through her legs for four.
Should have been stopped. No question about that. Here comes Kerr again. Into bowl to Knight. It's forward. Just for a moment, there's a little bit of a scramble as Knight has to get back in her ground as throw from Kerr back towards the stumps. Wide, I think Knight would have been back anyway, having defended the ball back to the bowler. Nine overs gone. It is 55 for one. England having been put into bat by New Zealand, winning the series 1-0 and looking to take a 2-0 series lead there for. You were playing yesterday, Alex.
Was indeed. We were playing at Beckenham. We won. Hey. The Thunder finished on a win, so we've had an up and down season. We've won three, lost the rest. I don't know how many we played. Lost four, won three, as Phil Long's correcting me to my left-hand side. And we finished joint fourth in the table.
You take that?
Take that. Phil's looking at me.
Joint fourth?
Yep, so fourth, fifth, sixth and seventh all have 13 points. We're ignoring the net run rate because we actually finished seventh. So we're saying we finished joint fourth.
Alex. No, this isn't how this works.
Yeah, net run rate doesn't count
it
anymore.
It absolutely counts.
No, we finished joint fourth.
England won a World Cup on boundaries. Net run rate counts. We finished joint fourth. To Huhu, he's bowling to Winfield Hill, plays the ball into the offside, and there'll be no run, Casbrook Fields.
Some details in life just need missing out.
Yeah, but not like the important ones, like if somebody, you know, put money on where your side finished, for example, or you maybe had a friendly agreement as to, or even bonuses if you finished in the top four, say.
Look, we've got the same amount of points as fourth has.
To Huhu. Moving into bowl, and it's defended by Winfield Hill. I imagine Christmas Day at the Hartley House must have been an absolute nightmare, playing board games.
Do you know, it was a nightmare, purely for the fact that Julia Hartley is so competitive, my mother, that even as kids she would never let us win. So we've just grown up losers our whole lives.
Or joint fourthers.
But no, it's nice to get a win yesterday, finish on a high.
In comes to Huhu, bowling to Winfield Hill, is struck high up on the pad, and there'll be again no run, 55 for one. So, how was your bowling performance yesterday?
Personally or as a team?
No, personally.
Yeah, I bowled quite well actually, thank you Henry. Thank you for bringing it up because it gives me the opportunity to talk about it.
Go on.
I bowled 10 overs,
yes.
Took 2 wickets and went for 17 runs,
hey.
And I went for 7 in an over.
Wow. So an economy rate of 1.7.
Yeah, it's probably the best day I've had this season. It's nice to do it last game when it doesn't matter.
Finish on a high. That's the most important thing. Well done you, Alex. In comes to Huhu, bowling to Winfield Hill. It's played into the offside. And there is no run stopped by Kasparic in the covers. And that is in the Rachel Hayhoe Flint Trophy. So the 50-over competition. The final of that is next weekend, next Saturday at Northampton. You'll be able to hear that on the BBC Sport website and app. So lots of ways to keep on following the women's cricket, because the domestic season may be done for you sides that finished 4th, 5th, 6th, or in the case of your team, Alex, 7th. But the top two teams will be in that final. This is whipped into the leg side. Nice piece of timing from Winfield Hill, and with a lot of space out there. Though it was aerial, it mattered not. 4 runs struck away firmly. 59 for one.
She's played that beautifully as Winfield Hill just off the back foot, clubbed into the leg side. There's nobody out there. Big smile on her face. She's happy with that one.
It's a good touch today, Lauren Winfield Hill. 21 from 32 deliveries. And she hasn't looked sort of bothered by the fact that she's not going at a quick strike rate. She's looked quite calm about needing to defend when the ball isn't there to be hit. Waiting now as to Huhu runs in from the digless end. That's played into the ground as far as mid-off. There is no run. Alex Hartley, some more thoughts from you on what sort of total we might expect. We're a fifth of the way through the innings. England 59 for one. End of the power play. And Emily Windsor standing by to take up commentary.
Well, England have set a brilliant platform here. As you said, the 59 for one after the power play. They'll be wanting to rectify what happened in the previous game when they had that batting collapse. They'll want to get up minimum around 280, see if they can push for 300. You know, if Winfield Hill or Knight can kick on, and hopefully Winfield Hill can get a 50. As we were saying earlier, she's not had one for a long time, so she'll have half a thought on that, I reckon.
Yeah, England made 47 for one in their opening 10 overs the other day. And as we mentioned, they then lost 4 for 31, champered them, and restricted them to 241 off those 50 overs.
From the new road end, number 74.
Yeah, I think this is an important knock for Lauren Winfield Hill. She's played nicely so far, 21. She's got that start, and she does need to go on if she wants to secure that top order spot.
Yeah, we were talking about looking at players who may and may not have had their spot secured for the World Cup, and that second opening spot I reckon is up for grabs, and she looks good today, does Winfield Hill.
Change of bowling from the pavilion end. Hannah Rowe coming into the attack. Be bowling to the England captain, Heather Knight, fresh off her 89 down in Bristol as Rowe comes in. That's a nick, is it? Yes, it is. It's taken. The keeper, Katie Martin, There you go. Heather Knight is dismissed for 18 off 21 deliveries. That's a big wicket for New Zealand, 59 for 2.
Well, it was beautifully bowled that by Rowe. It's just angling in towards the stumps and swings away at the last minute. Heather Knight tries to drive it through the covers, nicks it, and a good diving catch by the keeper as well.
Yeah, it certainly was. And from this angle for a minute, I thought she didn't take it, but that's a wicket, a big wicket for New Zealand.
Was caught by
after
Katie
a fantastic
Martin
power play
of Hannah Rowe for
bringing
18.
Nat Siver to the crease.
After some runs as well, Nat Siver, she not had the best of times against New Zealand in the T20s, didn't score all that many, and then the other day she ended up chopping on. Wasn't a great dismissal, so she likes playing at this ground. That's where she got her 88 off 33 ball. So she get herself in, knock the ball around, try and build an innings.
Tell you what as well, Hannah Rowe, first delivery of the game, dismissing the England captain. It doesn't get much better than that.
And an absolute beauty as well, is after the, you know, after a few overs, these Kookaburra white balls stop swinging, and they you end up just bowling. You have to just keep bowling, attacking the stumps. But that swung away beautifully from Hannah Rowe.
Yeah, and it was a great take by the keeper, diving to her right, Katie Martin. As Devine and Rowe just chat through a plan here to Nat Siver.
You always want to bowl full to Nat Siver when she first comes to the crease, because she likes to play off the back foot. She likes to punch the ball down the ground off the back foot. So if you can bowl just slightly fuller to her, see if she can go back to a full ball, try and get her out LBW.
She played on in the game down in Bristol as Rowe in again from the pavilion end into Siver. That's down the leg side. That will be a wide signal by the umpire. 60 for 2. Again, we're seeing a lot of extras here today, Alex.
Yeah, we are. It's one of those, isn't it, where you don't mind certain extras when the ball's swinging, but they just keep getting their line wrong, keep firing it down the leg side. They just need to try and adjust their line as soon as possible.
In comes Rowe again to Siver. Forward in defence to mid-wicket will be no run.
Yeah, 9 in wide so far today, 15 in the New Zealand innings in the first ODI.
I always say to our young girls at the death, when we're bowling at the death, I know we're not at death here, but if you have your fielders out on the leg side, I don't mind you bowling a leg side wide. It's when you're bowling off side wide. So when you're bowling both sides of the wicket, that's when things become harder.
In comes Rowe to Siver again. That's down the leg side again. An umpire stretches his arms. 61 for 2.
You can see what Hannah Rowe's trying to do here. As we spoke about, Nat Siver does like to go back and across and play off the back foot, so she's trying to go full at middle and leg, but she's just not got a line right.
Interesting though, if she is targeting that leg, something there's we sort of got a deep long leg and no square leg in place as there's a slip, so she really needs to get that line on off stump. As Rowe in again, that's better, and played back down to Devine, the captain at mid on, will be no run.
Much better that from Hannah Rowe. Ball still just swinging away as well, and if you can try and bring your slips into play.
Hannah Rowe, a tall New Zealand seamer, long blonde hair. She comes in again from the pavilion end. Little skip at the top of her mark and into Nat Siver. She bowled, and that's left alone outside the off stump this time. I feel like Nat just needs to give herself a chance here. She's got a lot of time to bat, and she hasn't got the score she'd liked so far in this series against New Zealand. She's got a lot of time here.
A lot of time, and she's, you know, one of the best players in the world. Batters always go through these stages, don't they, where they just consistently get out for not many.
There's Rowe in to Siver, played back down to mid-on again. Sophie Devine does the fielding.
And it's how do you get yourself out of that patch? How do you get to the crease, build innings, start again, and try and forget what's happened in the past? You know, Nat Siver is such a talented player. She's almost got too many shots. So can she just keep things simple, play herself in, and then start playing her shots?
In comes Hannah Rowe again to Siver. That's bowled and played again back to Sophie Devine. That's the end of the over. 61 for 2, and that's 11 overs gone. And I actually think Georgia Elwes, who's with us on commentary today, is a perfect example of that. She probably didn't start with the Vipers as well as she'd like with the runs. And down at the Sunrisers, she just battled through and managed to get this fantastic 100 not out. And then again yesterday, she's now in the runs again, 86 not out. And she just rode through that tough period, and that shows a player of class for me, being able to actually battle through those tough periods. Cricket can be a cruel game, can't it?
Cricket is a really cruel game, and in cricket you fail more times than you succeed. So it's one of those games where, you know, you are going to have tough times, and it's how do you mentally stay fresh? How do you stay on it? And when with the bat, how do you get through those tough times?
And enjoying it as well. At the end of the day, we play cricket because we enjoy it. Yes, it's people's jobs now. Yes, there's a lot more professional cricketers in England.
Talking about tough times, you got run out quite harshly yesterday, didn't you?
Yeah, well, I was going to bring it up with Georgia Rowis if she was trying to play some rugby yesterday with me, but we'll have to wait till she's on air to bring it up, I think, so she can talk it through. I'll let her commentate on the run out. There's Leah Tahuhu into Winfield. That's cut away. Dive nicely there at backward point for a dot ball. Lauren down there.
The tension in the box has just gone up a notch, hasn't it?
She said, Elvis in the back there said, I'll tell you from my point of view.
See, Georgia looked distraught when I was run out. Obviously, I was really upset that I was out, but I kind of found it a little bit funny. But as long as Georgia was there at the end to see us home, then I was happy.
Oh, it's a team game, isn't it?
To Hoo-Hoo into Winfield. Driven this time. Lovely shot. That's gone through the covers. There are about three fielders after it. Will they get there? No, they won't. Four more runs to Lauren Winfield Hill. She moves to 25. England 65 for two.
Well, we saw a beautiful cover drive from Heather Knight a few overs before, but that was even better from Lauren Winfield Hill. Just leant on it and nudged it through the covers. Cover is up inside the ring, and she's pierced them perfectly. And we had four players in pursuit of the ball, but the ball beats them to the boundary.
Winfield Hill on strike again. To Leah Tahuhu, slinging action, bowls. This time a thick outside edge, and this does beat backward a point. Kerr comes round at third man, does very well to keep it to a single. Winfield Hill moves to 26, 66 for two, England.
Yeah, Winfield Hill wanted the second there, but Nat Siver said no. A good bit of fielding from Kerr.
Winfield Hill, in the first game of the ODI series, got 21 off 24 and was dismissed down the leg side, trying to flick it off her leg through to the keeper. But she's looking in good touch here. As Tahuhu comes into Nat Siver, bowled nice and full, but played to Susie Bates, extra cover for no run.
Yeah, you mentioned Nat Siver needing some runs. Her scores so far against New Zealand this summer showing 14, 4 and 2 in the T20s, and she made 2 the other day in the opening game down at Bristol.
She's going to battle through though, Nat Siver, as Alex mentioned, a player of her class, one of the best batters in the world. Strikes the ball so cleanly. As Tahuhu into Siver, that's turned away on the leg side, and that will come through for a single. She's off the mark.
Nat Siver's one of those players, when you come up to play against her, you're scared of bowling at her, because she's so talented, she's so good, and you know once she's in and she gets going, she can absolutely take you apart.
Do you know what, I played with her at the Trent Rockets, and you don't want to bowl at her in the nets because I'm scared that it's coming straight back at me and I'm not getting out of the way.
She hits the ball so hard, doesn't she?
To Hoo-Hoo into Winfield Hill again, and that's forward in defence for no run. 67 for two, England. Yeah, she certainly hits the ball hard, and she hits just off the back foot, as we mentioned. New Zealand are bowling well to here. They're bowling full, but off the back foot, she can play with those fielders at mid-wicket, long on and square, because she just, as well as hitting the ball powerfully, she has that timing and skill to manipulate the field.
Yeah, she does. She's so good at, as you say, manipulating the field, finding the gaps and running hard between the wickets. I think there was a few years ago, we were playing T20 cricket, and she had the lowest boundary count but the highest strike rate, so she was just hitting the ball into the leg side, running to and pushing the fielders.
So 12 overs gone, 67 for two, still a slip in play for New Zealand. In the previous over, the captain Heather Knight was dismissed by a lovely away swing delivery from Rowe, so rightly so, keeping that slip in place. As in comes Rowe, that's in the air and taken. Nat Siver gone for one off seven deliveries. Just chipped to the cover fielder. And England now 67 for three.
Soft dismissal that for Nat Siver. We were saying she's short and runs. She just hasn't moved her feet enough there. The ball outside the off stump. She's looking to drive it. And she just chips it straight to cover. A simple, simple catch. And Nat Siver's poor form continues against New Zealand.
Yeah. She's searching for runs there. You can see that. She's just playing in front of her body. And she looks very disappointed walking off
Nat
here.
Nat Siver was caught by Maddie Green.
Took the catch there off rope. But good bowling from New Zealand. Bowling full, getting her trying to play that drive. But in comes Amy Jones, the England wicketkeeper.
England found themselves in a similar situation in the previous game. They had a brilliant power play, just lost the one wicket, and then in came that batting collapse. So they'll be looking to rebuild here. I think Amy Jones can just take her time, stick with Winfield Hill. Doesn't matter if your run rate slows down. The run rate at the minute is 5.6. Even if that goes down to 4.5, just as long as these two are there in the next 10 overs or so.
Incoming batter, number 40,
and it's interesting, isn't it? If you're looking towards the World Cup, England's middle order is probably the thing that you look at on paper that looks very secure going into that. But actually, as you said, in that first ODI, there was a batting collapse, and now today we've seen Knight go and then Siver quickly follows. It's really important that Winfield Hill and Jones Hill will build a bit of a partnership.
Yeah, it is, and you know, cricket's about partnerships, isn't it? And if you lose consistent wickets, your partner at the other end can't accelerate. You know, they have to slow down and try and anchor the innings. So Winfield Hill's got a really important job to do here, but you would say Amy Jones's job is much more important of trying to stick with Winfield Hill and rebuild here, because England have lost, you know, three wickets.
It's a slip in play. Rowe will be bowling to Amy Jones. It's just a long leg and a third man outside the circle. So they're still choosing to keep the fielders in the ring and attack. And as Rowe in, forward in defence by Jones, will be no run.
Amy Jones is always one of those players that I'm so desperate for her to do well. You know, I love her. I think she's a great, great cricket player and so good. And, you know, world's best wicketkeeper. You just always want her to get runs. Apart from when you're bowling at her in the 100 or whatever.
She's
happy for her not to get any then.
She's another one, though, that times the ball beautifully, hits the ball hard as Rowe into Jones, who just pushes to Bates at extra cover. Be no runs.
Solid in defence there, Amy Jones. Thou shalt not pass.
But that was a great line from you, Alex. Where that came from, I have no idea. 67 for three then, England, as Rowe at the top of her mark from the pavilion end into Jones, and that's driven sweetly. That's a great shot, mid off does well, diving to her left, Kerr that is, to stop that beating the field. But Jones off the mark with a lovely strike.
Brilliant shot that from Amy Jones, just down the ground, and a good bit of fielding again from Kerr. She's been a busy fielder today.
68 for three. Winfield Hill will then face Rowe for the first time. She's on 26 off 37. She really needs to anchor this innings. As in comes Rowe again from this pavilion end to Winfield Hill, and that's turned nicely to mid-wicket. It will be no run. Great bit of work in there from Brooke Halliday. 68 for three.
It's one of those situations that probably would have taken the single had they have not lost those two quick wickets there. And as you say, it's building partnerships, rebuilding, making sure they don't have another batting collapse. The last thing England would need now is a run out.
That's for sure. Both me and you dismissed by a run out yesterday, Alex. As in comes Rowe. So Winfield Hill driven sweetly down the ground, but Devine does the fielding. That's the end of the over. 13 overs gone, 68 for three. And Hannah Rowe, bowling figures are 2 for 3 so far from her two overs. So she's made an impact coming into the attack here at Worcester.
How I wasn't actually given out LBW yesterday is a mystery in its own, and then I managed to run myself out, so it was a great little cameo from me. A good strike rate though, I think 100, I'll take that, batting at number 11. Went for the paddle, it hit my pad. I was definitely in front of all three. I reckon it was hitting middle of middle, given not out, didn't know where the ball was, and just let the keeper run me out.
Do you know what? I actually don't know which wicket is worth more comical value, mine or yours yesterday.
We'll have to clip them up and put them on Twitter for people to see.
And then they can be the judge of... Everyone features, actually. George Rowles will be in there as well. He's part of the commentary team.
Look at that. We bring all the entertainment.
So, a change of bowling. Sophie Devine coming back into the attack for New Zealand. She'll be bowling from the Diglis end as she comes in to Amy Jones, and that's forward in defence, pushed into the offside. Casbrick does the fielding, will be no run. I like this from New Zealand, though, how attacking they are. We're obviously out the power play. They can have four fielders out the circle if they want, but they're only choosing to have the two.
Yeah, I like that as well, and I think they know that England are capable of a collapse. We saw it in the first game. We've seen it a few times, and if they can create pressure, put a bit more pressure on England's middle order.
There's Devine in again. That's a full toss. That's driven, but only to mid-off. Shot for a dot. She got away with that one, Devine. 68-3.
I've not heard shot for a dot since I played under 13s, I reckon.
Shall we send the bales to Wales in a minute?
Oh, God, that's made me cringe.
As Devine turns at the top of her mark. This is international cricket. This is England versus New Zealand. As Devine in, that's in defence again to mid-wicket this time. A little bit of a fumble there, but they are not going to take that on at this stage.
But yeah, you can just see New Zealand are really trying to create some pressure. Still got a slip in place. Cover inside the ring. They're all hunting, they're all running around. They're getting in England's faces.
As Devine again, top of her mark, comes into Amy Jones, and that's turned to mid-wicket. That's out! That's again another soft dismissal, and Jones chips it straight to mid-wicket. She's gone for one, 68-4 England.
Oh, Amy Jones, we see that so many times. She's got a bit of a habit of getting caught at mid-wicket, trying to flick the ball into the leg side. A soft dismissal, that, for Amy Jones. And the pressure that New Zealand were creating, well, it's got them another wicket. England's middle order, they're in a bit of trouble again.
They certainly are. There's just 13.3 overs gone. And Amy England Jones find themselves four Brooke down. The Sophia Dunkley comes to the crease with a lot to do here today.
Yeah, she does. I suppose if you're looking at England's batting lineup, what is good today is you've still got Dunkley and Wyatt. So Wyatt's coming in further down the order, opens the batting in T20s. But they've got a big, big job to do now, England. New Zealand have bowled fantastically. They've put the pressure on. They've taken wickets.
They certainly have. They've lost three wickets for just nine runs.
Yeah, Amy Jones just leaning on that, trying to flick it into the leg side, and literally flicks it straight to mid-wicket.
Also Charlie Dean to come as well, who in regional cricket bats at number four, so she's more than a capable batsman, but obviously only one cap to her name, a lot of pressure. You don't want to be asking too much of her today.
No, you don't. You also, as a, you know, number eight, you don't want to be going in after 15 overs.
She might like it though. Charlie likes batting time, you know, and
bit of pressure. How does she cope under pressure, Charlie Dean?
Do you know what? I think she's a great cricketer, as in her cricket brain, and she's very cricket smart. And I think when Charlie's in the middle with either the ball or bat, she just finds a way, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
She just looks at the situation and really takes it on. She's a real team player. So, yeah, I've under pressure, I think she could do a job. But obviously, at an international stage, the next level up, this will be a real test for her.
Yeah, and she's only young, isn't she? And that's why they've got her in this side. England have been missing an off-spinner, a genuine off-spinner that turns the ball. And they've found one in Charlie Dean. And she didn't have the best run out in her debut game, but she looked at home. She looked like she meant business. She was bowling the ball into the pitch, trying to turn the ball in towards the right-handers. Yeah. Feels like she just fits well into that England, in this England lineup.
Exactly. She offers with the field as well.
Yeah, this England collapse is 3-9 in the 22 balls since the power play finished.
In comes Devine to Dunkley, slip in play, but that's played in defence. Will be no run. New Zealand up and about. I spoke to Charlie after the game as well, and she said how nervous she was with the ball in the hand, and she sort of reflects. But obviously, Alex, you've had your first England cap. And I know you've sort of said off air it didn't go to plan, but after that first cap, sort of when you get to your second, your third, do you then sort of relax into it a little bit more?
Yeah, you definitely do. I remember my mum saying to me after the game,
in comes Devine to Dunkley, that's driven to extra cover. They come through for a quick single. Dunkley's quick between the wickets. Bates is tight there. Dunkley off the mark, 69 for four.
So I made my England debut and it didn't go to plan. I think bowled 10 overs, what, none for 60, something like that. It wasn't the best day, but it can happen. And I burst into tears after the game, went to give my mum a hug, and she said, Alex, you've got an England cap, nobody's ever going to take that away from you, you shouldn't be upset that it's gone wrong, you should be proud of yourself that you've got that cap. And that really stuck with me, because I was like, you know what, I can relax, I've worked so hard for this and I put so much pressure on myself to perform well, but you've done it. You know, your dreams come true, and Charlie Dean's done it now. She's got that England cap. No one's going to take that away from her, and she's got a real opportunity to prove throughout this series what she's made of.
Absolutely. And I think England will give her the opportunity to do that as well. Hannah Rowe still bowling from this pavilion end, just bowled two overs so far. They picked up two wickets, two big wickets of the England captain, Heather Knight, and that's Sivat. As she composes herself, Dunkley has a short mid-wicket right in her face. And New Zealand really are putting the squeeze on as Rowe into Dunkley. That's left alone outside the off stump. 69 for four. Again, though, Dunkley obviously is batting six in this England side, but when she played regional cricket at the start of the summer, she bats higher in the order. She usually bats three, doesn't she, for the South East Stars. So she is used to being in these situations early on in an innings.
Yeah, and I think that's what makes this England batting lineup so strong. You've got seven batters that are genuine batters.
Rowe into Dunkley, and that's turned to that close mid-wicket fielder, straight back into the keeper, the ball.
And all seven of them, eight of them, you know, with Charlie Dean, are capable of batting in the top eight, and someone's got to give. You know, you can't just keep bringing opener after opener, swapping it round. So they've got a really strong batting lineup, and as we keep saying, on paper it looks secure, it looks done for the World Cup, but they keep having these collapses.
Rowe coming into Dunkley again, that's driven nicely through the offside. That means business from Sophia Dunkley. Hit the boundary rope, four runs to her, five off five deliveries she moves to now, and 73 for four.
Yeah, Rowe there just hanging the ball outside the off stump, sixth or seventh stump. Sophia Dunkley so strong through the covers. She breaks her hands and whips it through the offside.
She's so strong through that offside, is Sophia Dunkley. But New Zealand, having picked up the four wickets, they can afford to be squeezing England, and they're not going to let that cover sweeper go out just yet. She's still in the ring. As in comes Rowe again to Dunkley, this time turned to that close mid-wicket fielder. There's no run.
I always love playing an ODI or a one day game, and you're putting pressure on, you've got slips, you've got catches, trying to get in the batter's faces.
Are you in slip usually, Alex, ready for the speckies or?
No, I will be as far away from slip as I can possibly get, because I'm scared of the cricket ball.
I thought you'd want to be taking speckies for the camera. As in comes Rowe, and that's turned again to that mid-wicket fielder by Dunkley.
Well, everybody knows I only take speckies. You know, I drop the easy ones and take the hard ones. And I'm willing to do that off camera if that's what it takes.
I'm not going to comment, Alex, but I was very disappointed actually when I read the No Balls tweet. Obviously, Alex, part of the No Balls podcast. Those that watched the T20 finals day yesterday, when Jordan Cox, as Rowe comes in, and that's turned to the mid-wicket fielder, that beats mid-wicket. They don't come through for a single, though. Bit of hesitant running there from England. 73 for four. And that's 15 overs gone. Yeah, when Jordan Cox did some outstanding bit of work.
Well.
And he didn't make the speckies only.
He didn't, because technically he didn't catch it. So therefore, he is not a member of the speckies only. He's specky assists only.
Make sure you watch that on the BBC highlights from the T20 blast yesterday. There's going to be a double change in commentary box here. There's that physio out on the field to Amy Jones, to Lauren Winfield Hill.
Yeah, a couple of tablets, I think.
As Izzy Westbury, a few thoughts from Izzy Westbury, and we're going to have a quick change in the commentary box, and Alison Mitchell will join.
What is happening to England? I don't know. Maybe I'm being too harsh, because actually there's been some terrific New Zealand bowling. I have been watching the Sophie Devine dismissal of Tammy Beaumont on repeat. And if you haven't seen it, if you've only heard it, I'm sure it was lovely being described via audio, but do watch it. Do try and find it.
Hello, Izzy. New over, and this is clipped down towards fine legs. Fielder on the boundary, and a single is taken. England, then, in this 16th over of the innings, 74-4. So, on the replay...
Yeah, you'll be pleased to know that during that little changeover before you came on, I was just telling all our listeners to go and get off and go and watch it.
Well, probably on the BBC Sport website, isn't it?
That's true, yes. BBC Sport on social media as well.
You can listen whilst...
We are a multi-format operation here.
Exactly. So digital clips on the BBC Sport website. More movement off the pitch, was it?
I'll go through it in detail.
Sophia Dunkley is forward. It's half stops at short mid-wicket, parried away towards mid-on, no run.
I think it's the whole context of it as well. Tammy Beaumont is the top-ranked batter here, in fourth in the world in ODIs. Arguably, I think she should be even higher considering her form. Last 10 innings, 83 runs, averaging 83 even. And to leave a ball and be dismissed like that.
Devine in, it's been driven. One hand comes off the bat, but fielded a tumbling stop at cover, and a run is taken by Sophia Dunkley. She's on to 75-4.
Conditions are not here conducive to swing. They're not overcast. It's a lovely sunny day, a nice deck at Worcester. And she's quite a skiddy bowler, Sophie Devine. She comes in right on, very close to the wicket, and just starts to swing it away. And you can just see it angling out, and then suddenly... it cuts back in like a fast offie. It's beautiful. And then top of off is gone. Amazing.
Winfield Hill on 27. Devine bangs one into the pitch. Just back of the length. Left alone by Winfield Hill. The wicket keeper, by the way, is no longer Katie Martin. She's left the field. Let's see whether we'll get an update on her. In fact, I can see her down in front of the dugout now. She's getting her gloves back on. So whatever the interruption was, Katie Martin off the field. Now Jess McFadyen is keeping wicket, who has not yet formally made an international debut. Looked to try and swing this away, left it alone the last minute. Winfield Hill down the leg side, wide signalled as it's taken by McFadyen. But yes, McFadyen, a Wellington player, 29 years of age, so... you don't get a cap like it. It's not going to go down.
No, well, I mean, the thing that just immediately reminds me of is the concussion substitute we had in the Ashes test with the men's Ashes test a couple of years ago.
Devine bustling in again to nudge it into the onside. It's come off pad, drops down into the turf, picked up, no run.
Where, of course, Marnus Labuschagne, or Labuschagne, depending on how you want
whether
to pronounce it, came in to replace Steve Smith after he was struck on the head by Joffre Archibald and got concussions. That was an official concussion sub, and he did get a cap for that match, I think. Did he? I think Labuschagne did. I'm pretty sure he did. And then also, it started off a wonderful train of form.
Devine, in now, back of a length again, just a bit of a duck and leaving it alone, as it is the end of the over. 76-4 then, England after 16. Labuschagne had already played Test cricket by that stage, and he'd already made his debut.
Yeah.
This is quite unusual, isn't it? Your first foray onto the cricket field is as a substitute wicketkeeper. But saying that, she's being subbed off now.
Oh.
And Katie Martin is back.
Brief but beautiful, one might say.
Well, she didn't do anything that really made you notice she was there. That's where all good wicketkeepers stand on the radar. But it's noted that Jess McFadyen has appeared and has kept wicket in a one-day international for New Zealand now.
Yeah, well, she'll have that forever.
Exactly. Winfield Hill on 27 off 43. She opened the batting alongside Tammy Beaumont. And as he mentioned, her dismissal was extraordinary. It was an over when there was a wide. There were three boundaries off the bat of Beaumont. And then she took a big stride forward and left one, which cut back in and took out the off stump and at wicket completely against the run of the early play. Winfield Hill on 27 as Rowe continues. Tall bowl, it's outside the off stump. She can stride forward, Dunkley, in defensive fashion. It's gone past through to the keeper.
Actually, to even extend that context as well, we were talking about, it was the way in which she had been batting in this match. In that over, I think she battered away three boundaries and looked absolutely in sublime touch. And he thought, right, here we go. Tammy Beaumont, she likes this ground.
But then backing up the wicket with Heather Knight being caught by Katie Martin off Rowe for 18. A couple of soft dismissals for Sivaran Jones as Rowe is in now and Dunkley is forward and she defends solidly into the offside. There's no run. Siva is lobbing a catch to cover off Rowe and then Amy Jones chipping another soft catch to mid-wicket. And Brooke Halliday was there to take that one. So Siver and Jones making one apiece. And that's brought Sophia Dunkley out to the middle. And we're still Danny White to come then. So she's in for Catherine Brunt. And a bit Brunt battered really nicely in the last game, making 40-odd. But having Danny White at seven will help in this situation. Inside the off stump. Run slightly towards short third. Slip moves across to field. And it's a dot ball, 76 for four in the 17th over.
This period now is so important. When is it not in cricket? But this is what we saw in the last match again, is that middle order, sort of from three down to six onwards, just has not been able to step in, to stand up, put your hand up when the top order perhaps has failed.
Right. Okay, steaming in again. Look to run it down and it's gone through to the gloves of the keeper, which is Katie Martin again. She underarms the ball away and Dunkley moves across to square legs, thinking, yeah, bit of an error with a play and a miss. The ball makes its way back round to row.
Because it was funny watching the last match, because I almost felt quite cruel, quite mean, sort of taking apart some of England's batting, because it was such a comprehensive victory in the end, 30-run victory when they posted 2-for-1. But you felt as though it was enough to win the match, but not enough for what England would have wanted.
Mm, and sense of Heather Knight saying we want to be ruthless. Well,
yeah.
The batting wasn't. Yes,
that wasn't there.
Eventually with the ball. But again, eventually with the ball. It's defence outside the off stump. Thinking about a quick single, but point coming in very quickly. Make sure it's a dot ball. I was looking at England's last ODI here. Of course, that was against India this summer. They've only played six ODIs on this ground, but the last was against India in July. And England batted first there and made 219, but were bowled out as they were in the first ODI against New Zealand. Or rather, were they bowled out? One moment, as
yeah.
Rowe is in, they were, yeah. It was a 40, was it a rain-reduced game, 47 overs aside. And then India chased it down with just three balls to spare. Dot ball off the end of the over, 76 for four then, after 17.
Yeah, they did chase it down that day, and a few of us here who'd maybe suggested that Mitali Raj didn't score quite quick enough took them home to victory.
So a new conversation then, a new debate.
Yes, that's right, yeah, exactly.
Well, what's the funny ground, isn't it? Because I think England's record here, having played six, they've only won two, I think, am I right in saying? Yeah,
that's right.
Lost four, including that low-scoring match against India in which Mitali Raj retained her crown, which, well, she'll say she'd never lost it.
Knight and Siver were in the runs that day, both of them coming close to a half century, but both of them out cheaply here today. So New Zealand at the moment have every chance of got England exactly where they would have liked them. Probably never quite imagined they would have them here. Winfield Hill facing up to Devine, cracking it away past point. There's protection on the cover boundary though. It's a single and Winfield Hill jogs through gently.
Yeah, we've mentioned England's collapse, but a word for Hannah Rowe, who's been bowling since the power play. Four overs, one maiden, 2 for 7.
Yeah, pretty tight. And getting the wickets. So doing an absolute job for New Zealand here at the moment. Bright sunshine, some fluffy white clouds in the sky, the spires of the cathedral in the distance beyond the trees. The grey concrete structure away to our left of the hotel that forms part of this ground now, as Devine's in again, and Dunkley, it's a full delivery on her toes as she crouches low over her bat, and as is her tendency, just to work that into the leg side, no run.
The worst thing about watching Hannah Rowe is that all I think about is Susie Rowe, who of players of certain vintage. She played for England in a couple of ODIs.
Very good hockey player as well.
I think she played for England in hockey.
Or,
yeah, she did. And she's a school teacher down in Canterbury.
Devine in now to Dunkley. She defends into the onside, no run.
Possibly about 10 years ago that she played for England. I'll have to look it up. But she was a big hitter with the ball. Not so much a bowler, but I mean, Hannah Rowe looks a bit like Susie Rowe. Blonde hair flowing. Very athletic as well.
She is very tall bowler, isn't she, Hannah Rowe? And yes, I've done a Susie already today.
Yeah. Oh, right. Well, there you go. Not just me then.
So nod to Susie. Hello, if you're listening. And Devine in past the umpire, right arm over, and Dunkley's driving. Drive forcefully. She always does, but she finds Susie Bates there at extra cover and no run.
But really interesting watching Dunkley bat at the moment. We saw it again in the first ODI, is that she, you know, her natural game, she has quite a solid bottom hand and she forces it quite often. It means that she plays really strongly across a square of the wicket, so very strong into cover point or square leg as well. Great sweeper of the ball.
In goes Devine. Well, she came forward. That's come off the edge and then just skidded into the ground to Katie Martin behind the stumps. She kicked it as if back towards the stumps, but missed the stumps.
Yes, a bit to be desired of Katie Martin's football skills there, I think.
Well, yeah, there's a lot of spin on that ball as it skewed off the outside edge. I don't know whether Dunkley initially was sort of looking to run it down or she was looking to play a solid defence, but the ball just skewed off the edge ever so slightly, skidding back towards the keeper. Last ball of the over from Devine. She's looking to drive once again. It's come off a thickish outside edge along the ground past backward point. Kasperick moves in off the deep third boundary. Cummings running back for the second. Good running. Initially thought there was perhaps only one in it, but Dunkley was quick out of the blocks to pick up two. And after 18 overs of the innings, England are 79 for four with Winfield Hill on 28 and Sophia Dunkley alongside her on 8. And this after New Zealand won the toss and put England in with Catherine Brunt rested. She had a bit of time off the field during the last game with a sore back. She had done a lot of batting as well as then started bowling. So she's rested. Danny White's come in for her and she'll be batting next in at 7. And then Freya Davies left out of the team for this one and Tash Farron has come in instead. And a few things to tell you about. We know that the Nobles Cricket Podcast is available on BBC Sounds at the moment, as is the latest BBC Stumped podcast as well, where we hear from inside Afghanistan, or at least relatively from recently from inside Afghanistan, from a member of the Afghanistan women's cricket setup who made her way to Canada, evacuated. Gives a real insight into the situation in women's cricket over there. As Hannah Rowe is forwarded in, and forward comes Winfield Hill defending into the offside, and there's no run.
Yeah, really a fascinating interview. I've listened to that a couple of times now. There's been so much debate around the state of Afghanistan cricket, its men's team, women's team, or non-existent women's team at the moment.
Yeah, Tuba Sangar, she was the women's development manager. She was appointed in 2014, but things really only started moving in 2019. As Rowe bounds in, outside the off stump, beating Winfield Hill to play that late and through to the keeper, no run. Yeah, as yet, there's been no definitive anything from the ICC, who are monitoring the situation, which I think is all they can do at this moment in time. And I tend to think, I don't know whether you've seen Izzy, actually, the United Nations have made a statement a couple of days prior to when I spoke to Tuba about the situation in Afghanistan and generally women's rights, clipped away behind square down to the boundary by Winfield Hill, and a single is taken. Where they refer to the general Taliban ban on women's activities as gender apartheid and bringing international law into it as well, which makes you remember that, you know, cricket is one part of this.
Yeah.
And perhaps it is going to take more of a global discussion about the way the world responds to the situation rather than cricket standing alone.
Of course, and you always have to talk about it within context.
Mm. Rowe in now to Dunkley, does run this away and gets it past first slip. Down to deep third boundary, but there's protection there coming back for the second. And Dunkley is back, and she's moving rather quicker than Winfield Hill between the stumps. She's always making it back for the second comfortably, and just think, well, I'll throw if it goes to the Winfield Hill end, just under a little bit more pressure.
That's what age does to you.
Dunkley. 82 for four. Slow ball there from Hannah Rowe. But yeah, it was just very useful, I think, hearing from Afghanistan.
Yeah, and
I think it's going to be so important to try and actually take into account what they want to happen from having lived through it and living through it. In goes Rowe. Dunkley defending. Ball outside off stump.
Oh, absolutely. And I think it's very difficult considering the different views from people with different experience, and very difficult at the moment also to talk to people who are in the country or remain in the country. And I think, you know, with the ICC and with the attitudes of other national cricket boards around the globe, of course, there's so much more than just cricket that's going on.
Rowe is in again, looking to cut that and slash it away, and another air shot from Dunkley through to the keeper. Just feel that New Zealand sense they're not far away from taking the edge of Dunkley's bat and creating a chance. It's the end of the 19th over, 82 for four is the England score now.
But just to round off on that thought, I mean, just because cricket is just one of many issues at hand doesn't mean that nothing should happen on that scale. And I think, you know, cricket was within the ICC's jurisdiction, and no, they can't talk or do anything about perhaps the education and other rights of women, but in terms of their ability to play sport, And that's where they do have a responsibility, and it'll be interesting to see. And I do, I think they have been monitoring the situation quite closely. Perhaps a bit of communication could come from them about before their, I think their scheduled meeting of their board is happening in November. It does feel as though a bit of urgency might be required just in terms of the public relations to show that they're addressing the situation, considering that at the moment Australia aren't planning on playing against the men's test team if the situation stands as is.
That's the thing, how long does the situation go as it is without a formal proclamation from the Taliban about exactly what their laws are going to be around women's activities? And at the moment people are deciding within the country, they're having to work it out for themselves. As Winfield Hill is driving up to mid-off, finds the fielder and there's no run. So I wonder whether you'd imagine sporting bodies are speaking to each other as well about what their response will be. And again, different sporting bodies might have different, slightly different rules, regulations, different parameters. But certainly that view that that Tuba Sangha expressed on Stumped about why she didn't want to see any sporting boycott. This is worked into the leg side by Winfield Hill. Singler's taken, fielder comes in from the deep, just the one. Throw comes back into Katie Martin. It was one that I hadn't necessarily considered, that a sporting ban would actually make it, wouldn't help the women's cause.
Absolutely.
And as she said, it's because we see the men play cricket that it then becomes obvious that we ought to be playing as well.
Agreed, and I think that's a really good point to be made. But another issue, I guess, with the whole conversation around women's cricket in Afghanistan is that there are two separate things at hand. There's test status,
yes,
and then there's membership of the ICC, and they're two distinct things. There's a lot of associate members out there that don't play test cricket.
That's true, and therefore they don't have to abide by those same rules. This is run again wide. Our first slip down to the deep third boundary and a single's taken, and England at 84 for 4.
So to explain to our listeners that to have test status under the ICC criteria, there is a higher burden on your commitment to women's cricket. If you're going to have be awarded test status than there is as an associate member.
For example, a country such as Saudi Arabia could be a member of the ICC without being a full member and having test status. This is pulled away behind square, but fine leg is there. A little bit of juggle, but fields it, and a single is taken. And
Saudi Arabia is but one. There's many, many countries that have associate member
and
status.
They have very different gender, cultural norms.
Cultural, religious, etc. But I think it's the test status, which is contingent on having funding and infrastructure and developing the women's game, that we're talking about here in terms of Afghanistan. Nobody, as far as I know, is saying that they should lose their complete membership.
Well, the statement from the UN human rights experts does back it. Wide sporting boycott. Forward comes Dunkley, getting ahead right over the ball, which again is a discussion.
Yeah, I mean, in an ideal theorised world, then that's something I would also back, but I also think that there are practicalities and standards and precedents to be upheld compared to other nations. It's a very, very interesting topic, perhaps not the one that I should go into in too much detail when we're commentating on an ODI in front of us.
But I will urge people to have a listen, because I think all you can do is to try and educate yourself around the situation and listen to as many voices from within and linked to Afghanistan as possible. Lobbed in the air. Oh. Catch taken. It's another soft dismissal. And it's Sophia Dunkley. She'd been really itching to try and find the boundary. And this one lobbed to short mid wickets. Didn't get hold of it. The timing wasn't there as she went for the pull. Dunkley has gone now for 11. And England are now 85 for 5 at the end of the 20th over.
Alison, I'm having flashbacks to the fixture here earlier this year against India, when it looked like a pretty good deck. It was a bit more overcast then, a bit more rain around. As you said, it was a reduced overs match, ending up with 47 overs aside in the end. But England, I think they fell just short of 200 or just above 200, and it felt as though they should have done a lot more. But only as the match progressed did you realise how difficult or two-paced the pitch was. And I wonder if it's something here the same. It's a beautiful day. The sun is beating down. As Ali Mitchell, I think, is going to make way for Henry Moran.
I'm going to wrap up that wicket because it was to Hoo-Hoo, the bowler, and Jensen with the catch. So 85 for 4. And that will bring out Danny Wyatt then at number 7. So a few more words from Izzy Westbury, then Henry Moran.
And I just wonder whether, I mean, it's all very well sitting here in our nice little ivory tower. We're not behind the bowler's arm either. We haven't got the best view. In fact, I've got a nice big pole in front of me. But it does feel as though the pitch is a little bit more tricky to play on than you might first think, which makes Lauren Winfield Hill, who's on 31 from 50 at the moment, all the better. Phil?
Yeah, an innings of two halves so far. England 59 for one from their opening power play in the second set of 10 overs. They're 26 for four.
Oof. Well, this much vaunted middle order, is this?
Was it much vaunted?
Well, we talked at the start of the programme that was a solid bit of England's team. That's the bit that we were certain would be pretty much unchanged going into the new year and the Ashes and the World Cup.
Well, I can excuse myself from that, so that's wonderful.
Stop it. Threadio's gone.
You were much vaunting it. But I think if you look at the previous match, that was where the area of concern was as well. Well, we saw that wonderful innings from Heather Knight, but then the middle order kind of fell away and you felt that there was England left something out there.
And what an opportunity this is for Danny Wyatt. We're going to see Kasparic bowling, a little bit of off spin from the new road end into Winfield Hill, who flashes that ball towards backward point, where a brilliant stop will prevent a run being taken. So the score remains at 85 for 5. England in more than a spot of bother here.
And in those 10 overs since the power play, 60 balls available, obviously, Lauren Winfield Hill only faced 19 of those.
In comes Kasparic again. Winfield Hill deep in the crease, shovels the ball into the leg side, out towards Hannah Rowe, who fields out at deep mid wicket. And England do get a single. So Wyatt on strike, and Danny Wyatt's ODI career is something that always statistically fills me with wonder, Phil. There are many elements to it that are surprising and unusual.
Yeah, the top one maybe is that she's batted at every position for England between 1 and 9. So she's never really found a home in this ODI team, despite being, you know, the go-to opener in the T20 format.
She plays in an England shirt for the 200th time today. Kasparic into bowl to Wyatt, who's happy to nudge that ball into the leg side. Picks up a single, will turn. It'll just be that one run.
Yeah, no, the real headline figure with Danny Wyatt's sort of batting career for England in her 78th ODI today. Just 100 and 150. An average of 19.
Which for a player of her quality is surprising. Winfield Hill, who's played brilliantly so far, gets one run behind square into the leg side.
Yeah, that's a bit of a chicken and egg though thing here, isn't there? The fact that she's, you know, is it because Wyatt has sort of flattered to deceive, or is it because she's been jugged around so much and never quite been given the opportunity to run and run that has caused that kind of disparity between what she can, we know that she's capable of, and what she's delivered?
That's in the air, beats the fielder, and will run down towards the boundary. What a good piece of fielding, though, that is in front of us. Rowe diving to her left to pick up. And after a firm connection, it would have been the expectation of a boundary, but instead just two. And England moved to 90 for 5 with the ball left of the 21st over.
Yeah, another thing to point out, of course, she came into the England team as an all-rounder. We don't see her bowl these days.
Wyatt deep in the crease, pushed into the offside. Single is rushed through. That's nicely played. And it'll see Danny Wyatt keeping the strike at the start of the 22nd. So England 91 for 5. Winfield Hill is on 33. Wyatt is on 4. Scores back-to-back in the T20 series for Danny Wyatt of 35 and 35 after a 14 in the first game. So she comes in reasonable form. Isabel Wester is looking around because I think we've got a change in the commentary box. Who's around? Who? Well, let me have a look at the rotor.
Somebody else in her ivory tower.
Somebody else? Is it Hartley?
Yeah.
Where is she?
Sunbathing.
Where?
No, she'll come over in a minute. I'm quite happy.
Well, what it might actually... No, we're going to make the change. We're going to have a commentary change into the commentary box for a debut on Test Match Special. Because we have got an Antipodean representative.
You've rather thrown...
No. Christy Havel plays in Canterbury in New Zealand and is joining us today. She's going to talk in the interval. She is going to do some commentary with us as well. And she knows this New Zealand side. And since Hartley hasn't turned up, Christy, you're going to be on a bit earlier than we thought. Hello.
Hello. Sorry, that was quite an abrupt change. You really took me by surprise.
Well, there we go. Lovely to see you. We're going to get some New Zealand thoughts in a moment. 91 for 5 is the score as to who is in. That's nicely played by Wyatt. That'll bring runs. And it'll bring 4 behind square on the offside. Cut away up on the toes from Danielle Wyatt to get her first boundary The score 95/5. So, Christy, you play domestic cricket in New Zealand. You're over here playing some cricket as well this summer. And you can give us a lot of insight, I hope, about this New Zealand side, who we know bits and pieces about, the big names perhaps. But there's some other names around the periphery we know a little less about. Lea Tahuhu comes in and bowls to Wyatt down the leg side. Wide signal, 96/5. I mean, first things first, this is a pretty healthy position for New Zealand.
This is an outstanding position. I was a little bit nervous coming to the ground today. You never know what to expect with the White Ferns as a long, passionate supporter. So very happy with where we're at, but they will want to consolidate this position, absolutely.
Is there a bit of a sense that New Zealand, they can be a little erratic as a side?
Very much so. Okay. Yeah, that is definitely the feeling. So we never take a win for granted, but we also never take a good position for granted either.
In comes Tahuhu to bowl to Wyatt, ducks underneath a quick delivery, and flies through to the gloves of Katie Martin. Because, you know, this is a big 12 months for New Zealand women's cricket. World Cup early next year, there's a, you know, a real onus and expectation presumably back home.
Absolutely, and I think for the World Cup to be a success hosting wise, we really need this White Ferns team to be firing on all cylinders. Otherwise it makes it really hard for the New Zealand public to engage with it, and that's what we really need for women's cricket.
Yeah, here comes Tahuhu charging in to bowl to Wyatt, who is beaten. She'll probably argue she left that alone, but it looked like a little prod forward down in front of us. It's one of the features you get at Worcester, Christy. Occasionally you get one of those trolleys that rumbles past carrying some food.
Is that our lunch?
It might be our lunch. It could be. Stop. Come back. And so occasionally you just get that little rumble in the background.
It's a beautiful ground.
Isn't it? Is this your first visit?
It is.
Oh,
yeah.
Sensational. Here comes Tahuhu bowling to Wyatt, who's up on her toes. It's sort of in midair as she plays that shot through the offside. It's not going to quite reach the boundary. Picked up and hauled in before it gets to the ropes at deep cover. But they will get back for three. So that's good running. And England creep towards the 100 mark, 99/5. And you've also, and this I love, is you've absolutely embraced the England cricket experience. Because yesterday you were at finals day in Birmingham.
And it was out the gate. Yeah. I don't know if that's a saying you get much over here, but it was something else. I've never seen or experienced anything like that. It was incredible.
That tends to be the reaction to T20 finals day as to who moves into bowl. And Winfield Hill will play that ball behind square on the leg side to pick up the single that will bring England to 100. 100/5. We've got a full left of the 22nd over. Lauren Winfield Hill is on 34. Danielle White is on 11, and England, though they're five down, do at least have three figures. So you were at Birmingham yesterday. Were you in the Holly stand?
I wasn't. I wasn't too far away, so the fancy dress was outstanding.
did you indulge in the fancy dress yesterday?
I didn't. No, I was on my best behaviour yesterday. but no, really enjoyed it.
Tahuhu running into bowl to Danny Wyatt. That's defended, nicely played. Back towards the bowler. End of the over, 22 gone. England 100/5.
I think my favourite part was when the camera people at the ground would find particular costumes, mm-hmm. and then they would play a backing track to it.
Yeah,
that
so
was
had,
my, I think that was my favourite.
We had Indiana Jones.
Yes.
Bit of Guns N' Roses yesterday.
Star Wars. Scooby-Doo. Yeah. We had all sorts. It was outstanding.
Yeah, I sometimes wonder if there could be a horrible mistake and actually somebody who was just wearing their favourite hat was misidentified as Indiana Jones and would be completely baffled as to what was going on.
Well, it was like the umpire in the first one-day international the
yes.
other day in Bristol. He had a very different-looking hat on,
didn't he? It was very much Indiana Jones.
Yeah.
I'm glad you noticed that. It was all a little surprising. But we seem to have got more regulation umpiring gear on today. As we see Kerr at the end of her mark. Running into bowl to Winfield Hill. Drives nicely out to deep cover for a single. England 101/5. Winfield Hill moves on to 35. And we see Jess Kerr bowling once again. What can you tell us about Jess Kerr?
Well, other than I think immediately people jump to, oh, is she Amelia's sister? Which she is. But Jess Kerr's definitely come into her own right the last couple of seasons. Had a stellar 2019-20 season for Wellington, which then saw her White Ferns call up and then a contract as well. So definitely now becoming embedded in this White Ferns attack, and with the movement that she gets is definitely a big asset.
She's enjoying these conditions, moving in right on over to bowl to White, and keeper standing up to the stumps, collects the ball that's left alone. And so she's sort of becoming part of that sort of regular mainstay of the armory with the, and presumably New Zealand conditions, they're sort of more similar to this than anywhere else in the world.
Yeah, absolutely. I think, you know, we saw her getting a lot of movement in that first game, but potentially just bowling a touch too full, which sort of lent to her getting put away for boundaries.
White on strike, that is a full delivery. It's punched into the offside, out into the deep for a single, which will move the England score to 102 for five. So where, you know, realistically, are New Zealand expecting sort of semi-finals of the World Cup?
I think that's always the aim. And definitely the girls will back themselves. We do put a lot of pressure on ourselves to perform.
Kerr coming in, long strides past umpire Milnes. It's pushed defensively into the offside by Winfield Hill. There's no run.
It's hard though, isn't it? Because obviously now more and more teams coming into their own. South Africa, especially West Indies, you never know what you're going to get with them. And then obviously India, Australia, England. So, you know, there could, five or six teams doesn't go into four, so someone has to miss out, but the girls will definitely back themselves to make semi-finals.
In comes Kerr, bowling to Winfield Hill. It's that good timing back to the bowler. We've got a ball left of the 23rd over, England 102 for five. And so I suppose the question is, what will the home backing do? Will it give them the boost? Will it be the 12th man, if you like, or will it be the pressure that could get to the side? And that's the unanswerable question at this stage, I guess, as Kerr moves in for the final ball of the over. And deep in the crease, Winfield Hill trying to find the angle on the offside. Can't do so. Collected at backward point, and the score 102 for five. I mean, would you expect big crowds?
New Zealand grounds aren't huge in their own respect anyway, so there isn't the huge expectation of packing out tens of thousands of people. But we will definitely want big crowds there. Again, COVID could have the last say on that. We did see a couple of matches when England toured during our home summer that were played behind closed doors. So we'll definitely hope for big crowds. We have a lot of grass embankment grounds, which lend a lovely setting. So it is during, school has already started back by the time the World Cup is on. So, you know, hopefully some parents get their kids out of school to come and watch some cricket. But fingers crossed that COVID plays its part and stays away, that allows us to really enjoy the summer.
Yeah, well, fingers crossed. Phil?
Yeah, that World Cup starts on the 4th of March, the final on the 3rd of April, and England play New Zealand in a group game in Auckland on the 20th of March.
And where will that be in Auckland? Will that be Eden Park?
I think it will be. Okay. So that will be, they will need to try and, if it's on the main ground, they will need to try and get in a good crowd because it's a bit of a concrete jungle.
It is, yeah. Tahuhu bowls to Wyatt at the start of a new over. Run towards backward point and fielded in front of us by Lauren Downs. So one on to the total, 103 for five. I mean, in some ways, quite a good ground for the women's game because short boundaries straight, so you could get some big scores.
Yep, definitely. I think one Sophie Devine and perhaps Nat Siver would definitely be eyeing up going big down the ground there. But it is a great ground, but can feel quite vast.
Yeah, absolutely. Played away into the offside nicely, up on her toes by Winfield Hill. She gets another run, moves to 36. England 104 for five. And so that's all to come in the World Cup that, as Phil says, March the 4th is the day to look out for.
The final, of course, at the best ground in the country, Hagley Oval.
Oh, is that right?
Hope to see you all there.
Yeah, well, so Hagley Oval is Christchurch.
Yes.
And whereabouts in New Zealand are you from?
Christchurch.
Okay, down the lakeside, and White helps it on its way for a single to find leg. 105 for five. It is a lovely ground. That is one of those grass bank. Yeah. And it's in a park.
It is. Yeah. I'm not from Christchurch. I shouldn't say that. I'm from the west coast of the South Island, but Christchurch is home ground for the Canterbury Magicians.
Magicians is a great name for a team.
Thank you. We try our best.
That is a belter. In comes Tahuhu. To bowl to Winfield Hill. Playing again into space in the offside. Have to be quick, and the throw comes in from Susie Bates. It's wide. I think probably would have been safe enough. 106 for 5.
Yeah, the Magicians is a sub-editor's dream, isn't it? At the end of the game yeah. for various headlines.
Oh, yeah.
Pulling things out of the hat and three-card tricks and all yeah. sorts. Yeah, fantastic.
Weaving a spell, all those things.
Especially when you've got the likes of Amy Satterthwaite and Leah Tahuhu. You can definitely... who put in performances regularly, they love them. They're a sub-editor's dream.
Yeah, I can imagine you can have some fun with that. In comes Tahuhu. The far end, the Diglis end. Nicely timed by Wyatt into the offside, but there's no run because the fielder, Brooke Halliday, is waiting. And so that competition that you're a part of, you play in Christchurch, is that the equivalent, I suppose, to the Rachel Hayhoe Flint tournament here?
Yeah, so we have our what we call the Halliburton Johnston Shield, which is our 50 over competition, and then we also have the Dream 11 Super Smash, which runs concurrently with the men's as well, similar to 100.
Okay, so that's your sort of your real condensed form. Here comes final ball of the 24th. Wyatt is surprised in a way by that bounce, nudged into the leg side, and a single will see her keep the strike. 24 overs gone, 107 for 5. We won't get into this entirely because during the interval you're going to join us and talk us. We're going to talk with you and Izzy all things about how, because we know quite a lot about how the game works domestically in this country, also Australia, but we know less about New Zealand and as one of the sides, as you say, one of the big six, looking to really progress in the game and dominate. It'd be interesting to find out a little bit more about how it all works in New Zealand, because that is an area that my knowledge is certainly reasonably limited on. So we'll look forward to that during the break. But we're close to the halfway stage of this innings, Christy. 107 for 5. England, well, they're in a little bit of bother here.
Yeah, but as we say, I mean, Heather Knight and Catherine Brunt the other day surely made a good job of repairing things. I have no idea. I've not seen the wicket and obviously haven't been to this ground before, so I don't know what par is, roughly.
Then that's something that our friend Phil Long might be able to help us with. Start of a new over sees Wyatt playing the ball to the left of mid-wicket, but won't find a single because Sophie Devine sprints in from mid-on. I mean, we did speak about that massive total against Pakistan in 2016, but...
on that day, there I am. But on that day, the boundary was right in. Remember, Mark Robinson made a policy of bringing the boundaries in so that the women would be able to clear the rope.
Here comes Kerr. Wyatt wants to single into the leg side, won't be there. Satterthwaite waiting.
And it was also against Pakistan, which, with the greatest respect to them, don't have the quality of New Zealand here today.
And so typically, because there's not a great sample size in women's cricket here.
No, there's not. There was one game here, of course, earlier on in the season. England made around the 200 mark, which India just got home with Mitali Raj, as we mentioned earlier, proving us all wrong.
Oh, yes. That was some day. Here comes Kerr. Right arm over to bowl to Danny Wyatt. It loops up off. I'm not sure whether that was a bit of back, glove, thigh guard. Either way, drops into the leg side. We'll wait to see what umpires... signal is, and in the matter, you can always tell when an umpire's about to signal leg by because they put their hand out ready to lift the thigh and give it a tap on the leg and tell the scorers that it is off the pads as opposed to the bat. 108 for 5. Winfield Hill will be on strikers. Turning, moving in is Kerr to bowl to Winfield Hill. Keeper standing up to the stumps. Now that's defended. This is good economy, and this is what New Zealand were looking for, isn't it? Is to, after those wickets, put the pressure on with economy.
Yeah, I think they did let things slip a little bit in the first one-day game, but I think for the most part they would have been pretty happy at how they hung in there, because England are a quality side where things could rapidly have spun out of control and gone up, you know, towards 280, 290, so they definitely would have been pleased with how things finished.
Kerr coming in. Right arm over to Winfield Hill, who defends into the offside, and there is no run. And England will be looking at this as... you don't want to devalue a series by saying it's purely a warm-up, and it isn't a warm-up for the World Cup, but you want to be in situations as a team, don't you, where you're given that challenge and see how you respond.
Yeah, I think so, and I think for New Zealand, I mean... we often say, oh, we were so close if whats and maybes, but we really need to get over the line and get some wins under the belt.
Kerr into Bolt to Winfield Hill, into the ground. That's nicely timed, but once again, straight back to the bowler, who's bowled a tight line there. How many off that over? Just the one leg by, so really good effort that from Jessica. Right, I'm going to get out of the way. Christy, some more thoughts from you, and then you're going to be joined by Emily Windsor. And the question I'm going to pose to you is, from what we've seen so far, I mean, what would you think New Zealand be comfortable chasing?
Yeah, so England 108 for 5 after 25 overs, the halfway mark. I think New Zealand the other day, they were chasing about 250 and made a real hash of the run chase. So I think if they could right the wrongs from the other day, 250 is chaseable for them. But again, need to stay tight with the bowling, need to break this partnership because Winfield Hill and Wyatt could really settle in here and kick on. Hello, Emily Windsor.
Good afternoon. What a pleasure to be alongside you, Christy. And you must be very delighted with New Zealand's start so far.
I am. I've been dancing around the media room, which probably isn't overly impartial of me, but
well,
c'est la vie.
We do have a Susie Rowe shirt in front of us, so you're not the only New Zealand fan here.
Susie Rowe or Hannah Rowe,
sorry.
So, Lee Kasprick, the leg spinner into the attack, will be bowling to Danny Wyatt, who's on 15 not out. It's Kasprick in, and that's turned nicely into the leg side by Wyatt. She'll pick up a single. She'll move to 16, 109 for 5.
So I wonder where this fellow New Zealand spectators come from. Can you see them?
Yeah, I can. I actually know who she is. She plays domestic cricket for the Central Hinds back home. I think she comes over here and plays for Berkshire.
Oh, lovely. So all New Zealand fans here at Worcester. It's Kasprick into Winfield Hill. Turn nicely again into that onside. They think about a single, but there won't be one there. Jessica does the fielding. 109 for 5.
She plays for the same domestic team as Hannah Rowe. And I think there's a couple of other Hinds, Central Districts Hinds, in this team as well. So she'll be here supporting her teammates.
And are they a team to beat in your competition? Have you gone head-to-head with this player in front of us? As in comes Kasprick to Winfield, and she's driven down the ground nicely to long on for a single. She moved to 38, 110 for 5.
Not personally, as far as I'm aware. We have in a T20. Last season I did play in a game against them, which we did come out on the right side of the ledger for. But no, they're a good side. Very difficult for them as they are spread out all across the North Island, so it's hard for them to get together and train regularly. So, yeah, quality players for sure.
As Kasprick in to Wyatt, who advances, and again forward in defence will be no run. And I suppose that's a big difference, isn't it, between English cricket domestically. You sort of can get in the car. There's obviously the hub at Loughborough where England train. Obviously for New Zealand international cricket, you've got players coming from all over the country in order to train together as a group. There's Kasprick. Thinks about coming in again. Long on, mid on is now dropped to long on for Danny Wyatt. As she comes in and she uses her feet again forward in defence. And do you think that makes a big difference in terms of how regularly New Zealand internationally train?
Well, I caught up with Susie Bates just last week, actually, after her 250th game for New Zealand. And she said how crucial it was that the Kiwis caught up fortnightly through the winter.
It's Kasprick into Wyatt, who rocks on the back foot, pulls away, but only finds mid-wicket. Will be no run. Good end to the over, that from Kasprick.
Normally, they only sort of catch up once a month for camps through the winter. But she said, you know, there was a big effort this winter before flying out to England that they caught up fortnightly camps. And that sort of alternated between the South Island and the North Island. And so the amount of time that they've spent together is effectively doubled. And she said that that's not only helped them playing-wise, but also to become more connected as a group and to really work on their culture.
New road is number 17.
So I think, yeah, it can be difficult, especially when you've got established players, superstars, you know, like Satterthwaite, Devine, Bates, Tohu, and Kerr now as well, picking up contracts all around the world. It is hard for them to find time to be together, but COVID sort of lent itself to them all being back in the country.
The off-spin of Satterthwaite into the attack, and that's dropped onto the back foot by Winfield Hill. That's cut away nicely out to the cover sweeper. Sheer move to 39, 111 for 5. And I suppose with those superstars going off to the big bash or to the 100, wherever they play, that does really restrict the time that as a group they train together.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think it also impacts, you know, obviously it impacts how much they are around their domestic sides as well. I mean, some of these girls, over the last couple of years on balance...
Satterthwaite into Wyatt, who's reverse scooped that nicely down to third man. The ball skips on. There is a fielder after it, and she does well to get there. So they come back for a couple, and Wyatt moves to 18, 113 for 5.
On balance, they don't play a lot of one-day cricket because they sort of they might tour with New Zealand and play a couple, but then they don't play regular one-day cricket because they jump from T20 league to T20 league. So this will be the first time in a while that they've played regular one-day cricket.
Cut away nicely that by Wyatt. That's gone past the cover point fielder. And they come back for a couple again. Great running and attacking bats batting this from Wyatt. She moves to 20.
We've had a tweet in from Hypercourse, and he's suggesting that Christie is being rather modest about the Canterbury Magicians' performances last season.
I may have done. I haven't had a lot to do with it personally, but yes, we did have a good season.
Current holders of both the one-day and T20 titles.
Satterthwaite in again, and as she hit that, I don't know, but the keeper didn't collect it cleanly. So it's a dot ball.
Actually, in Bristol, when Leah was absolutely teeing off, Leah Tahuhu, she hit 3 big sixes at the Basin Reserve in Wellington off her White Ferns teammate Casper to lead us to the T20 title from nowhere.
In comes Satterthwaite, and that's pitched straight to Susie Bates at extra cover. It'll be a dot ball.
I can't remember what the game situation was, but Amelia Kerr took a hat-trick that decimated our middle order. So I think we must have needed 40 off 15 or 3 overs.
Satterthwaite in again. That's cut nicely out to the cover sweeper by Wyatt. Sheer move to 21 off 26, 116 for 5. So she's certainly one that can hit big with the bat, Leah Tahuhu.
She can. 3 big maximums that really brought us back into the game and snatched the trophy from the jaws of defeat. It was the stuff of a movie, to be honest. But yeah, no, a great season. We don't really know at the moment what this upcoming season looks like because we've had the Delta COVID variant breakout into the community. So we'll wait and see what that looks like. But yeah.
Leah Tahuhu then is a player. We know she's absolutely outstanding. What's she like off the field?
She's a real joker. Yeah, loves to dish out a bit of banter.
In comes Cass Rick, the leg spinner, to Danny Wyatt, who's gone to sweep that. That's down the leg side. Will be signalled a wide by umpire Anna Harris.
No, she doesn't take things too seriously off the field. She's always the first to suggest a board game or a bit of cards. Or
Cass Rick comes in and then pulls out of her run-up. Anna Harris again signalling dead ball.
Really loves to give you a hard time if it's warranted. So she's great to have around.
Cass Rick into Wyatt, who's play a miss outside the off stump this time. 117.
Just having a look. Yeah, Casper's a big drifter of the ball. She is an off spinner, but not a huge turner, but gets a lot of drift going away. So it can be tricky to get a read on what the ball's going to do.
She's a clever bowler as well, isn't she, Casper? She varies her pace and her length. There's Casper into Wyatt, and this time slightly quicker than played to mid wicket. Will be no run. And we saw that in the T20 series, actually. She really, really was destructive with the ball in games because she buried her pace so well.
Yeah, she can really float it up and also dart in that quicker one, which gives everyone trouble.
Darted in this time, and that's cut away by Wyatt. Will that split the two fielders out there? No, it won't. They come back for 2. Oh, they're both at the bowler's end.
Uh-oh.
Oh, no. And that is a run out. Not what England needed. And Danny Wyatt has to go, and that's such a shame to end the innings like that. I think it will be Danny Wyatt that goes.
I think so.
the umpires are looking together.
Neither of them are keen to go, are they?
No, a real mix up here, and no one panicked from the White Ferns as well. When you're in that sort of situation, it's easy to get ahead of yourself and not execute your skill. So a good throw from Halliday, well gathered from Casbrook, and well held down the other end by Katie Martin.
You feel like if they both went there as well, they would have made that run comfortably, but there was just a bit of a mix up. The incoming batsman will be Charlie Dean, but we're just going to have a look at the replay here.
Is it Wyatt that turns back?
Wyatt gets halfway and then says no, as Winfield Hill was already there.
Will it be Winfield Hill?
Yeah, it looked like Wyatt got back first, didn't she, and grounded her bat, and then Winfield Hill came through behind her.
So Winfield Hill, it looks like, is walking off disappointed, bat overhead. And what an innings it's been from her. 39 off 66, and she's really battled hard and looked good there for England. And what a way to get out when you're playing like that.
Lauren Winfield Hill was run out for 39.
And I think for her, we knew that she's been making starts, she needed to go on to secure that opening spot, and that's really disappointing for her.
That's right, we've mentioned before today that she hasn't made a 50 for, I think this will be now 24 innings. But her scores this summer in the ODI, she made 16, 42, 36 against India. She's made 21 in the first ODI here against New Zealand, 39 today before she was run out. So she's got the starts, she's not gone on to make those scores.
I think it was Alex Hartley earlier who said that they definitely wouldn't want to run out for the way to get a dismissal here, those two. So it's unfortunate that it's happened, but it is New Zealand's game. So Charlie Dean at the crease. Emily Windsor, I'll ask you, how does it feel to have two Vipers teammates, Southern Vipers teammates, out in the middle together?
Yeah, it feels good. And I think for Charlie, that would give her confidence, having obviously she batted in that previous game but sort of came in with sort of 10 or so deliveries. So she didn't have much of a role to play. But actually here, there's 23 overs left and she needs to do a job for her England team here. So to have that familiar face of Danny Wyatt in the middle, I think, give her confidence. But a big innings this actually for Charlie. She's more than capable with the bat. She's obviously coming in at 8 here, but she bats at 4 for the Vipers. She's used to playing in middle overs, so this actual situation, if you like it, obviously 6 down is not ideal, but the situation is how Charlie plays coming in. So will be a big innings for her. Fingers crossed she does well.
Oh, she's got plenty of time here. Hopefully they're running between the wickets is up to scratch. I'm not sure. I haven't watched these two bat before, so I hope their calling's good.
Yeah, and I think if you're Danny Wyatt now, obviously that mix up with Lauren Winfield Hill, you as that senior player have to bat on. Obviously Winfield Hill, 39 off 61 from opening the batting, really was playing the anchor of the innings. And obviously losing her now, Wyatt doesn't want to quickly be joining her in the pavilion. This partnership needs to be important here. And they're going to put the pressure on Charlie Dean. Slip comes into play to the leg spinning Casbrick. That was a breakthrough, a timely breakthrough for New Zealand. 118 for 6.
Yeah, the partnership had reached 33 there for the 6 wicket before that run out.
So close mid-wicket, close extra cover. That ring filled up for Charlie Dean. She's a good sweeper of the ball, but early on, she'll be looking to play straight down the ground. As in comes Casbrick, and that's forward in defence by Charlie Dean.
Yeah, she'll be looking to add to her one. Was it one run that she made the other night? She'll be looking forward to trying to add to that here. Plenty of time to do so.
Yeah, as I said, this situation really does suit the way Charlie bats and the style of players. Casbrick bowls a nice full toss. That's a way to get off the mark. Driven through the covers for 4. Thank you, Lee Casbrick, Charlie says there. And the score moves to 122 for 6.
That is a freebie from Casbrick. Charlie Dean has held her nerve and put that away in fine style. Sometimes you get a full toss and you make a meal of it, and it either can result in a dismissal or a dot.
And actually, Charlie has worked really hard all winter on her cover drive, so she'll love to get that one out as Casbrick comes in, and she leaves this one alone outside the off stump this time. 122 for 6. That's 28 overs gone and 22 remain.
You've got a few words here, and I'm going to hand over to another Southern Viper, Georgia Elwes.
We're a bit Southern Viper heavy here. in the commentary box and out in the middle for England with Danny Wyatt and Charlie Dean. So we try not to be Southern Viper bias at all. But the Southern Viper hero, Georgia Elwis, who's probably about 180 odd not out in the last few weeks, and seeing the Vipers over the line. What are you feeling for the Vipers teammates out there, both Charlie Dean and Danny Wyatt?
Yeah, well, a really good opportunity, I suppose, for them both to spend a bit of time at the crease, and these two will enjoy batting together. They obviously know each other very well.
Sathathwaite in to Wyatt, and in defence back to Susie Bates, 122 for 6.
That four, that last over from Charlie Dean, beautiful shot. That will really settle her nerves. Quite a busy player, isn't she? And she'll be looking to be active here.
Sathathwaite in, and that's swept by Danny Wyatt. That's in the air, but one bounce. The fielder at deep square can't do anything to stop that. Wyatt, four more to her total, and she moves to 26, 126 for 6.
Yeah, lovely shot here by Dan. Sweep shots to an area of her game she's really worked on, trying to improve, and Amy Sathathwaite just drifting down the leg side allows that shot to come out, and she's got a good connection on that, and away it raced.
Sathathwaite in again, forward in defence this time from Wyatt. And obviously for her now, obviously that mix up with Lauren Winfield Hill, it's really important she does go on.
Yeah, it is. I don't think she's not someone who gets too bothered about things like that. She's very easygoing.
Sathathwaite in, that swept away again, and that one's hit harder. But the fielder comes round, she's been moved squarer, and they come back for two. Wyatt will move to 28, 128 for 6.
Yeah, both of these are busy players, and I think that will really suit the way that they need to go about this next 20 overs or so for England. They'll be looking to rotate the strike, put the bad ball away when it comes, and not do anything too high risk.
Sathathwaite in, and this time cut through the offside, but a great stop by Down at point. Nothing gets through her there. Exceptional fielder. Wyatt stays on 28, still 128 for 6. Sathathwaite, the off spinner, in again, and this time cut, same result, but that's gone through the legs. This time, that's the old commentator's curse, saying what a great fielder she is. But they come through for a single. Wyatt to 29, 129 for 6, and that's 29 overs gone, 21 remain.
Yeah, I think these two will be fairly happy. Like I said, they've enjoyed batting together over at the start of this summer, and spent a lot of time together at the Southern Vipers, so they'll know each other's games. Both of them extremely quick between the wickets, aren't they? And so they're going to run well together. They just need to spend a couple of more overs rebuilding here, being really low risk. I think what you know you're going to get with them is if there is a bad ball, they are going to latch onto it and they are going to put it away.
And Casbrick continues. Leg spinner, and she starts her mark into Wyatt. She bowls, and that's forward in defence. They're going to come through for a quick single. That's great running. The cover sweepers out to Danny Wyatt, and she makes the most of that. 130 for 6.
Yeah, who do you think is quicker between these two?
It's got to be Danny Wyatt. We can't be giving Charlie Dean credit for any sort of speed.
Oh, that's a bit harsh for Dino.
No, I'd say Dino's a clever runner, isn't she?
Yeah.
She knows what she can and can't make. It's Casbrick in, and that's turned to mid-on for no run. Nice straight back from Charlie and a little prod of the pitch. She's looking right at home there.
She is, and she'll enjoy facing this spin. So she's someone who feels more at home against spin. Lots of wristy shots behind the wicket as well, so I'm looking forward to her pulling some of those out later.
Casbrick into Dean. Shorter delivery down the leg side. Not signalled a wide by Anna Harris.
Oh, that's a bit harsh there. Oh. Oof.
That's one that, as a batter, you're sort of looking back at the bowler going,
hang on a minute.
But a good dot ball from Casbrick is what we would call that. As she comes in again, this time forward in defence, played back to her.
I always like a ooh from you two, especially because I know what you would have said if you'd have been if you'd been facing there.
Especially Georgia Elwis, who
I'd have been right in there at the
white
give me that wide.
Over to our right. Casbrick in again to Charlie Dean. And she's cut that away. That's a nice shot. The cover sweeper's gone out. And the final ball, as they want Charlie Dean to be facing the majority of deliveries. There's one ball to come. 131 for six. Charlie Dean moves to 5 off 7. Kasprick in again to Wyatt, and that's a player miss outside the off stump. As you hear some rattles below us, I think that's the food moving along towards the dressing rooms, the players' dressing room. But that's 131 for six. A few more thoughts from Georgia Elwes, and there'll be a change in commentary position. Alison Mitchell will join Georgia.
Yeah, I think that was a really clever over from Kasprick then. She mixes her pace up really well, and she's got this arm ball that she just flicks off her index finger, and it's really difficult to pick up. And I think she's been deceiving Danny Wyatt a little bit with that, and hence the play and miss from that last ball.
Hello, Georgia.
Hello.
Well, wickets have tumbled, haven't they? But this needs to be a steadying partnership. It needs to be a lengthy partnership, doesn't it? Because there's a lot of overs still to go in this innings. 131 for six after 30 of the 50. And it's Charlie Dean on strikes after the weight is in. She goes back, defends into the onside, and finds the fielder. Picked up by Jess Kerr there, and no run. Yeah, so two wickets for Rowe, two for Devine. Tahuhu dismissing Dunkley, and then the run out of Winfield Hill. Satterthwaite in again, a little quicker this time. Sweep, strong, and along the ground, behind square on that leg side, a sliding stop in front of the rope, saves the boundary. They're coming back for two, and the throw goes to the end that Charlie Dean is running to, and she had set off, I think, looking for two immediately. But Danny White's also quick between the stumps, so even if there is a little bit of a momentary hesitation, you feel like she's got enough pace to accelerate and make it up, and it was a well-judged two in the end. So Dean onto 7 from 9, facing up again. A tickle into the onside. Very definite and loud call of yep, yep, yep. And they go through for the one, fielded in the deep. And back into the gloves of the keeper. England 134 for six now. Yeah, two who look very quick between the stumps out there at the moment.
Yeah, and they're just rebuilding quite nicely here. I don't want to give them the commentator's curse, but looks like they're playing really low-risk cricket and rotating the strike quite easily.
Yep. And Satterthwaite is over the wicket again with her spin defence that time. Back up the pitch. Bates is there to pick up, and there's no run. Yeah, they came together after that run out. 117 runs on the board at that point in the 28th over. It's now 134 on the board as Satterthwaite's in again, fires it in a little bit quicker. It's defended into the onside once more, and there's no run. Have you had a chance to talk about the runouts that happened yesterday in your game from your perspective?
No, I haven't actually. I'm quite looking forward to being able to do that.
Where's Emily gone? In goes Satterthwaite, and again forward defending into the offside. So a few nice accurate deliveries from Satterthwaite to end that over. We've had 31, Dean on 8, Danny Wyatt 30 from 39. Both of them looking busy out there, 134 for 6. So, paint the picture, Georgia Elwes.
Okay, here we go, I'll set the scene. So, I've been, I've bowled 10 overs, I've fielded 50 overs. I'm a bit tired. I've been at the crease a while as well, maybe 30 overs. Emily Windsor comes in. Let's run, let's run, let's run. Okay, that's fine, we can run. But she'd hit the ball straight to mid-on, and she called late. So I'd turn round to go back to the non-striker's end, thinking that there was no run.
Kasparik, new over, over the wicket. Fuller beaten outside the off stump. There's an appeal for a catch behind. It's a half-hearted appeal. I think it dies away pretty quickly. Keeper and bowler, and a dot ball then. No interest from the umpire at all. 134 for six, but yeah, just lunging forward on the defence, and no sense of wanting to review either. So, went to mid on.
So I've turned back, thinking, oh, she doesn't want to run that one. And then all of a sudden I hear this, yeah, 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 yeah. And she's steaming towards me. And
I'm just looking out the window for a moment, because they have actually gone for the review. It was taking an awfully long time. It just seemed as if the field was set ready for the next ball to be bowled. We'll come back to the story, because also we need to find out whether the call, you know, was made. That might have to go out to the jury. But New Zealand are grouped together. It took an awfully long time for Kasprick, looking back towards Sophie Devine, to say, shall we review it? And they're allowed 15 seconds to do it, but we can hear if that comes across through our effects microphone, the voice of Sue Redfern, which is echoing around the PA system here at New Road now. So it's Charlie Dean, who was on strike.
They didn't seem awfully confident at first, did they?
Absolutely didn't, but every team has got
Okay, the ball two is reviews. Close to the bat, so I'd like to check with Ultra Edge, please.
Flighted, foolish delivery. Going for the drive. Play it through. The covers.
Flat line, play it through. There is a spike. Oof. Okay, I'd like to go back
wow.
to the field, please.
Ultra and Edge shows a spike. That is a very, very good review, whoever called that out. For New Zealand, because that is a crucial wicket. These two were looking like, just like they were building a little bit of a partnership, rotating the strike with ease, and Charlie Dean has to go.
Charlie Dean was caught.
Well, almost again out of nowhere, isn't it? The seventh wicket's gone down. Dean has gone for eight. But yeah, an appeal which it did come immediately from keeper and from bowler, but they just lost interest immediately. And then, as I said, seemed ready just to bowl the next ball. But the delay came, and right at the last moment, they went for the review. And indeed, it was a well-judged review. Charlie Dean gone for eight, 134 for seven in this 32nd over. And New Zealand now have a real chance to try and bowl England out here. So many overs left in the innings. Eccleston walks out to join Danny White. We know she can be handy with the bat, absolutely, but there's just almost, well, there's far too many overs left. England want to be seven down at this stage.
Yeah, it's almost a deja vu from the last game. Far too many overs for this middle to lower order to bat. And we've seen Sophie Eccleston. She's, you know, a fantastic batter in T20. She's such a clean striker of the ball, but just fear here that we'll need one of her more mature innings, I think, to bat with Danny White here and to get England up to something that they can feel like they can defend.
Well, but five more balls in this Kasparic over. Can she do any more damage here? New Zealand are looking to set the field to Eccleston. Katie Martin with the helmet up, standing up to the stumps. Will they get a slip in place for the new batter? Yes, they will. Looks like Satterthwaite's going to stand in the first slip position. Got backward point, cover, extra cover. And mid-off, mid-on, mid-wicket. Fielder's back at deep mid-wicket and fine leg. So here's Eccleston facing up to her first ball. It's fired in quite quick, and she's pulled it around the corner very low. All the way along the ground, down towards deep fine leg. Just really helped it down that leg side. They're coming in for the second, and well-judged three back there. That is good running. Quite a chase back for Satterthwaite from slip, but Danny White very quick, making sure Eccleston was responding in kind.
Yeah, that'll get her going. She's sat on the sideline for 30 overs, and that'll certainly loosen Eccleston's hamstring. So she's giving them a good stretch now. Yes, probably not expecting to run a three first ball.
So 137 for seven. What it has done is get Danny White on strike. And this is going to be quite important, isn't it? To face as many balls as possible. Kasparic had a bit of a false start to her run-up. White wasn't ready, but she is now. And Kasparic over the wicket. And White is forward, looking to drive. Pushes it up towards mid-off. Finds the fielder, though, and no run.
Yeah, you know, Danny White's really annoying to bowl to, especially in the nets, because you think she's ready, but she takes an age to look up from her stance.
Kasparic, the whirl of arms, in again now, driving once more, finding the gap this time out to the deep, through the offside between cover and backward point. Fielder on the boundary sends the ball back in, and White takes another one. She's on to 31. I'm glad you didn't just stop them with Danny White's really annoying.
Well, I mean,
probably,
yeah.
At times that's probably a valid comment.
The way she hits it sometimes, it's not very nice. But even more so when you charge in and think she's ready and she's not ready, you have to start all over again.
Eccleston with a slip in place faces up to Kasparic. Forward she comes, stroking it up to mid on along the ground. No run.
Georgia had painted the picture before that caught behind, and I'm with bated breath to see who was to blame.
Well, we've got one more ball in this over, so I think with the spin on, I thought let's just wait till the end of this over then. So Kasparic, last ball of the over to Eccleston. More flight to that delivery. Meets Eccleston, the low full toss. Pushed out towards wide mid-off to end the over. 138 for seven, then Eccleston, three, and White on 31 after 32 overs of the innings, in an over which Charlie Dean was caught behind for eight. Right, the story then. Your run out. Sorry, Emily Winter's run
Emily's
out yesterday.
Yeah. Well, I'm not quite sure where we got to, but she hit it to mid-on.
Yeah.
Hadn't called yes initially, so I turned back to my crease, and then all of a sudden, yes. So we ran, and then all of a sudden we were running. It was like slow motion, collision mid-pitch.
Oh,
And I was thinking that they were going to throw to my end and I was going to be run out, so I was ready to pull out the big dive, and then I heard the stumps clatter at the other end and the big celebration, and I couldn't even look at her as she walked off because I was just, what has just happened?
She's not in the room to verify. No, that's she's, an accurate yeah,
that's,
recount.
That's my version of events. I'm sure she'll have a different one, but...
Well, was it the late call that's to blame, or
yeah,
was it
that's
not looking
at
each other for
an
the
unfortunate accident, I think.
Perhaps that's a diplomatic way of describing it. Jessica from the new road end of the ground, in now to Wyatt. Right arm over, Wyatt's forward, and she's defending to the offside. And again, Susie Bates is there to field and no run. Well, what can England get? I mean, three wickets in hand. How much can Wyatt, if you like, sort of trust Eccleston here? Is she going to be really neat looking to farm the strike?
I think she can trust her. I think she needs to talk her through. These two are very good friends, actually, so they'll have a good understanding of how each other plays, but she will need to be that calm, mature head in this partnership.
Keep her standing up to the medium pace of Kerr. She's beaten. Going to play that out through the offside into the gloves of the keeper. Again, she's got to be careful because with the keeper standing up, she can't advance and can't move out of her ground to try and take on Kerr as such, so she's got to be mindful of that.
We have seen a fair few player misses from the England batters today, haven't we? I just don't know whether there's something in the pitch where off a certain length it's kicking up and deceiving them a little bit, but more than I remember, they're having a few player misses.
Deep thirds just come up inside the circle here, and now it's Kerr who's pulled out of her run. Was that because Wyatt wasn't ready?
I tell you, she's a nightmare. Absolute nightmare.
Watch her very closely here. So does she almost do a sort of double preparation where you think, oh, she's ready, but then...
She just has her head down for ages.
Head down for two taps, and then eventually looks up.
She's ready now.
She's ready. Kerr comes in from the end of her mark past the umpire. Now bowls Wyatt. He's into the offside, eager to try and take a single, but points there to move forward and pick up. No run. She stays on 31.
If I was a bowler, I'd continue. I'd just carry on. Try and sneak one through while she's not looking. It might be the only way you can get her out.
Never mind, you need to be ready. Taps her bat again, looks up down the pitch. Sees Kerr now coming towards her. Over the wicket she bowls. It'll follow on the drive once more, but can't get it past Susie Bates, who tumbles to her ground just on that hard bit of cut strip, extra cover position. It's been very tight all day, really, Susie. I can't remember much getting past Bates.
No, and I think Jess Kerr's bowled really well today as well. The line she's bowled has been really difficult, and that's brought Susie Bates extra cover into play. And yeah, like you said, not much has got past her.
Wyatt awaits Kerr in, takes some pace off, and that's drilled along the ground, but again can't get it past. Mid off this time, straight to the fielder, and Danny Wyatt's left off looking up at the sky, thinking, how am I going to pierce this field? Not sure where the best options are.
Yeah, that was a lovely shot for no runs, and I think this is where Danny needs to just keep ahead, keep calm, not get frustrated, because like we said, there's so many overs left in this innings.
In goes Kerr. Going back, gets it past quite backward point this time, and does find the boundary. Well, that's what she's been looking for. A different approach rather than coming forward, going back that time is the way to go. And a thump of gloves between Wyatt and Eccleston, because it was a boundary off the last ball of the over, and England now 142 for 7 after 33.
Yeah, that was a lovely shot by Danny Wyatt. It's such a strong area of hers through that backward point third man region, and a little bit short from Jessica, a little bit of width, and Danny Wyatt just pounces on that and puts it away nicely.
Really good crisp shot. Phil?
Yeah, Danny Wyatt moves on to 35. We mentioned earlier her scores in the T20s earlier on against New Zealand, 14, 35 and 35. So, can she move on this time? It's something she's not done a lot in ODIs in England. The highest score in England in ODIs is only 42.
Well, that'd be a bit of a marker, won't it, if she can better that. See how that puts her for the remainder of the series as well. Eccleston, it's a low full toss, driven up to mid-off. Again, straight to the fielder. Got to be finding the gaps, got to be putting enough power on these balls to work it through, but at the moment, Kasprick bowling really well to her field. Up inside the circle on the offside. This is aerial, but drops just in front of cover and Leah Tahuhu. And chases back to field, and they're able to take one. That was aerial.
Yeah, I must say, all the batters who've come in have struck the ball really cleanly, which says to me that it's a good pitch. And if feel even if England can get up to 200, which looks a long way away, it still won't be enough.
Kasperic in as covers drop back onto the boundary and White's skipping forward as if she wanted to take on the bowl and just adjusted and opted to defend instead, but very mindful again of Katie Martin standing right up to the stumps to Kasperic here. 143 for 7, 34th over. England asked about first by New Zealand as they did in the first ODI. Down the ground, up and over, she got it over mid off. Yes, just over the top of Sophie Devine, who was running back. Sure, she really got all of that time, Wyatt.
It was in the air for a while, wasn't it? Sophie Devine was interested, but strong area of Danny Wyatt's just got over her head, a metre too far away from her.
Managed to scamper a single, Wyatt onto 36, as Kasperic in now to Eccleston, a flatter delivery. Eccleston forward and defends, out to Bates, an extra cover, and now a gap does open up with Tahuhu dropping back onto the cover boundary once again. So just toying with her field. A bit Kasperic and toying with the batter. Past the umpire and again flatter once more. Eccleston opting to defend and Bates once more moves in, picks up. And New Zealand just have felt like they've been able to crowd England with their infielding today. It's been a good effort from them and 34 overs are gone. England 144 for 7. Wyatt on 36. Eccleston on 4. Just a reminder of those wickets that did fall. It was an incredible start to the innings because after an over where Lauren Winfield Hill just couldn't get the ball off the square. Tammy Beaumont then faced up for over number 2 and creamed 3 boundaries off Sophie Devine, who also bowled a wide and just looked a little out of sorts. Then suddenly sent down a ball which Beaumont took a big stride forward to and left. And it came back in and took out the off stump and hit the bails. So she went for just 12. Second wicket was Heather Knight, caught by Martin off row for 18. Nat Siver and Amy Jones both out to the soft dismissals, offering a catch to cover and to mid-wicket respectively. They only made one apiece. Sophia Dunkley made 11 before she was caught by Jensen off at Tahuhu. Got Rowan again here outside the off stump to ease it away behind point but can't squeeze it through and fielded and no run. So yeah, it was a clatter of wickets through that middle period. Charlie Dean looked to be building something alongside Danny Wyatt until she was caught behind on review. Very well judged, albeit late, but good job they went for it in the end, New Zealand, given not out originally. Defence from Wyatt, back up the pitch and no run. Yeah, it'll be interesting until you really get a feel for how well England can bowl. Kind of difficult to judge, but certainly below par at the moment.
Yeah, New Zealand will be the happier of the two sides for definite here, and it's going to take a mature innings from both of these two to see us up to a good total.
Wyatt awaits. It's in the air off the bat, but then drops comfortably in front of backward point, and there's no run. I mean, what Wyatt can do here, if she and Eccleston, and then we've got Kate Cross and Tash Farrant to come, is that sense of momentum, isn't it? At the back end of the innings, you can just haul it around and at least go in having not been bowled out and having frustrated, because New Zealand now looking at, right, bang, 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 let's bowl them out. England have got to first of all make sure that they see through the 50 overs. It's a bouncer. It's been chopped almost sort of tennis style. Managed to keep it down, White, up on her toes, and then chopping it down into the ground out towards the cover boundary and takes one. That was an extraordinary shot.
She's done well to reach that, hasn't she? Like you said, playing it actually in the air, I think, in the end. And one run for it, but
did her toes come off the ground?
Bit eventful.
It was banged into the pitch short. She leapt. She did, played it with both feet fully off the ground as if she was maybe at the net in tennis and going for some sort of forehand swat. Swatted it out towards the cover boundary.
Oh, she's not a remarkably tall girl, is she? But that was a very high bouncer from Hannah Rowe.
An athletically played shot in the end. Two balls left in the over and Sophie Eccleston is looking around the field and seeing that fine leg is back on the boundary. There's deep mid-wicket as well. What's she going to get this time? Will it be another one dug in? It is dug in. Oh, and it's a catch to mid-wicket. Well, it's worked. It's another soft dismissal. It's another ball that's just been really lobbed to the fielder. Oh, the Eccleston, well, she knew that deep mid-wicket was back there, and she's rather just fallen for the trap, the short ball, and Eccleston gone for 4.
And England 145 for 8. Yeah, you feel like she could have hit that anyway. It's such an instinctive shot. When you see the short ball, you know you've got to react quickly. And
Sophie Eccleston was caught.
Unfortunately for Eccleston, she has just handed an easy catch to Satterthwaite at mid-wicket. She'd put that 1 yard either side of her, she'd have been getting runs for that as the leg side boundary was out, but not to be, and she departs for 4 from 8 balls, and England really in a bit of trouble here. Kate Cross has been in good form with the bat this year with her domestic side, so she'll be able to hang around, but we're going to need a really good innings here from her and Danny White to get England up to something that they can defend.
It's going to be a real challenge, isn't it? And as far as soft catches go, there's been 3 of them in the innings now. Siver, Jones, and that there to Satterthwaite. It was just a comfortable catching height, wasn't it? And no power put on it.
Yeah. The England batters are going to be really disappointed with this. I feel like all of their dismissals really have been soft, have been gifted to New Zealand. New Zealand have bowled well today, but I think England's batters will feel like they've got themselves out rather than New Zealand have bowled some gems to get them out, and a lot of them have been caught in the ring by, you know, just poor shots really. And
yeah, and throwing the run out as well, it's been a bad day at the office, hasn't it, so far. Yeah,
misjudgment from Beaumont with the big leave at the top of the innings. So last ball of the 35th over now is Rowe, who has got 3 wickets now, bowls, and it's running way down to very fine deep third boundary. Does get Kate Cross off the mark, but another over, another wicket. England 8 down, 35 England overs, 145 for 8. Danny White still there on 37, 54. So, so much depending on her. She needs partners who can stay with her, but she also needs to just find that control, find that rhythm.
As we welcome back,
Alex Hartley.
If you know the answer to that question,
well, I'll let you ponder over just how England are going to get up to what might be any sort of competitive total here, but just the nature of these dismissals. It's been a very disappointing day with the bat so far. And then Henry Moran's coming in.
Yeah, it has been really disappointing. Obviously, New Zealand winning the toss and electing to field first, putting England in, and they just haven't had any partnerships, haven't had anyone stay there. So Kate Cross here just needs to stay with Danny Wyatt, let Danny Wyatt accumulate the runs.
It's not gone well, has it?
No, it's not gone well at all.
I think is the way of phrasing it. There's clouds overhead rolling in. Phil Long's got his microphone poised.
Well, and if anyone's just joining us, of course, England were 59 for 1 at the end of the 10-over power play.
It's all fallen away since then. Here comes, at the start of a new over, Kasparek to bowl, and that is beating the outside edge of Kate Cross's bat, lunging forward. And bails are removed, but no danger of a stumping. How good is Kate Cross at batting? You live with her, you know her very well, you play with her in the Northwest.
I mean,
be honest, she can't hear.
No, she can't hear, but a lot of people can. She can bat, but she's number 10 for a reason.
Okay. In comes Kasparek again. Cross is hitting the ball aerially towards backward points, and the catch is taken. It was a bit of a lunge, bat well away from the body, and a 9th wicket falls. England 146 for 9, Kate Cross goes for 1.
Yeah, another soft dismissal for England. Just pushing, looking to push that into the offside. A leading edge and a good catch, good diving catch from backward point, but the scowl on Kate Cross's face just shows the mood that England camp are going to be in.
That's a pretty minging dismissal, that, isn't it?
Yeah, but it's probably not the worst of the day. We did have 2 batters at the same end at one stage.
We did. Yeah, to offer a ray of light for England here, your side defended a low total yesterday, Northwest Thunder in the Rachel Hayhoe Flynn.
We did. We defended 185. So you never know. These things are possible, but we were on a Bunsen burner, which helps when you've got a team of spinners.
Indeed, and this doesn't actually look like a track that's offering that much in terms of spin. It looks pretty true.
It does look pretty true. There's been a couple of balls that nipped. Tammy Beaumont obviously leaving the ball and the ball nipping back towards her and clipping the top of off, but there's no demons in this pitch at all.
So, Farrant comes to the middle. Tash Farrant joining the party a lot earlier than I think any of us expected her to be, with England finding themselves at 146 for 9. This really is a pretty bleak position for them to be in, having been put into bat by New Zealand. Sophie Devine said at the toss, Alex, it's the sort of toss you'd like to lose. Quite hard to decide what to do. Well, I bet now she's pretty pleased with what's gone on having put England in.
So always that as a captain, the coin goes up, you shout tails, it lands in the tails, and you're like, oh, I was hoping that we wouldn't win that one because we have no clue what to do. But they decided to field, and, well, the guesswork's paid off for them because England currently 146 for 9 even.
Tash Farrant, a rare thing in English women's cricket, a left-hander. As round the wicket comes Kasparic, and Farrant is lunging forward in defence. She did score 35 for the South East Stars against the Lightning in a T20 not that long ago. So she can do a little bit with the bat.
Yeah, she can. I think all of the England batters, like Kate Cross scored a 50 for Thunder last week. She can bat. But, you know, you're into the, you know, at the tail enders now.
And, you know, international cricket, with the greatest respect to the domestic game, international cricket is a step up.
It is indeed.
As we see Farrant on strike in the sunshine. There are a few clouds overhead, but the sun's shining at the moment. As in comes Kasparic, striding forward round the wicket. A little pause behind umpire Harris, and then in. Farrant drives. That's a nice looking shot away through the covers. Lovely timing, and it's going to race, I think, all the way to the ropes indeed. Four runs for the bat of Tash Farrant, and that is a really nice piece of batting. England moved to 150 with that.
Well, a beautiful shot from Tash Farrant. There was no cover. She's just nudged that into the offside, and it's flown away to the boundary. Get her in at number 10.
Oh dear. A lovely shot. That's almost as good as anything we've seen today. Kasparic interval to Farrant, who's forward correctly in defence. Born in Athens, Tash Farrant.
Was she really? Are you making that up?
No.
Good fact.
And there's a number of this England team that were born
elsewhere.
Elsewhere, yeah. Am I right? Japan for Natsiva, I think. Here comes Kasparic to bowl to Farrant, and that's another good shot. He meets it on the full and whips it round the corner for four runs. Useful runs as well, because you just never know. It may feel like a lost cause for England, but every run will help, and that is a good couple of strokes. 154 for 9.
That it was good. She's played the sweep shot. She plays the sweep shot and the reverse sweep so well, but she's leant forward, got it on the full, and, well, she's probably got the best strike rate of the team.
Yeah, going at 200 at the moment, 8 from 4. England 154 for 9 at the end of 36 overs. It is Test Match Special with you here on 5 Live Sports Extra from New Road, Worcester, for the second One Day International between England's women and New Zealand. England 1-0 up in the series, but at the moment looking like it's quite, wouldn't be the most outlandish shout to say it's looking quite likely to be 1-1 at the end of this. But stranger things have happened.
Stranger things have happened. If they can bat their overs, still plenty of time left in the game.
Here is Hannah Rowe, right arm over to bowl to Danielle Wyatt, who's still there, playing really well on 37. We've just been for a little stroll around the ground.
We have. I've actually had a bit of a shocker. So I've ordered some food to be delivered, which is due in the next 10 minutes.
Well, I'm sorry.
I'm hoping one of our lovely colleagues will go for me.
I'm not going.
Well, you're on air too.
Phil's scoring. Here comes Rowe, bowling to Wyatt, who gets hold of that down the ground. And that's going to be six. Six runs back over the bowler's head. A show of aggression from Wyatt, who is a dangerous customer. She moves to 43, England 160 for 9.
Yeah, two things about that shot. First six of the series. And also, Danny Wyatt goes to her highest score scored in England in ODIs.
Love that from Danny Wyatt. England 9 down. She knows she's got to be there at the end, but if the ball's there in her arc, she's going to hit it, and that's exactly what she's done.
That's a really good shot. You'll be able to see that as an in-play highlight on the BBC Sport website live text in the not-too-distant future. Rowe into bowl to Wyatt again. Wide delivery. It is signalled wide, not just by the umpire, but by a gentleman in a black baseball cap down below us with the grey hair.
You always know it's a wide when the crowd are calling him.
Oh, yeah.
A proper wide. Two wides.
I don't know about you. I've got very long limbs. I don't know about you. You don't. I do, right? Who are we kidding? In comes Rowe to bowl to Wyatt again. England 9 down. It's in the air, flashing away towards deep cover. Wyatt will pick up a single to move to 44. England 162 for 9. But, I sort of find myself stretching quite a lot when I'm just sort of doing, whatever, standing about. And if I was an umpire, I think I'd make quite a lot of errant signals that might confuse things a bit. Similarly, if I was one of those people at an airport with the ping pong bats.
Yes. You'd be sending the airplanes in circles.
Yeah. So this plane goes sort of reverses the wrong way around. Sorry.
They don't reverse planes, do they?
Yeah.
You can't put them in reverse. I thought you had to be taken back by a truck.
Farrant on strike. 162 for 9. Digs out a full delivery. Well, they have something called reverse thrust. Right. Where when you land, you will see the plane... The engines will go into reverse because it slows it down, right?
Yep.
But I don't know if actually on the ground they can reverse.
You can't reverse thrust when you're on the ground.
I don't think you can. I mean...
Is it so they can reverse in the air but not on the ground?
They certainly can't reverse in the air, aren't they? Comes Row. This is smacked away towards backward point from Farrant. 162 for 9. What airline have you been on?
None recently. I can't go anywhere.
This journey's taken a long time.
Hold on a minute.
We're going backwards.
That cloud was going the other way.
Speaking of backwards, do you ever drive down the motorway or do a long drive to a cricket game and you don't feel like you're going anywhere? That was me this morning. Felt like I was driving for an age.
162 for 9. It's on the hips of Tash Farrant, which will get one down towards fine leg. And in doing so, actually keep the strike at the start of the 37th over. 37 have gone. It's 163 for 9.
Go on, Alex. Tell us about your journey.
Go on, Al.
So I set off this morning and had to get up very early to travel from London to Worcester. So my alarm went off about 6:15 in the car by about 7 o'clock. It gets to like 9:30. And I'm like, how am I not there yet? I feel like I'm going backwards.
Were you?
I wasn't in reverse.
I'm in the car, but I should feel like I'm going back. Yeah, I know what you mean, those sort of interminable journeys. Motorways will do that, by the way.
And Sunday morning, no traffic, so there was no entertainment. There was no, I can't people watch.
If your form of entertainment is traffic...
It's been a long summer.
It has been a really long summer. Yeah. Hobbies and interests, traffic. You must meet my friend Alex. She's absolutely fascinating. Passionate about traffic jams. Can't get enough of them. 163 for 9. Leah Tahuhu is going to try and blast out the England number 11, Tash Farrant.
Who before today only had one ODI run.
Well, she's on 9 from 7 so far as Tahuhu moves in, drops it short. That's well played. Swivelling and pulling the ball down the corner. Round the corner towards Kasparic for a single to move to double figures. And England 164 for 9. Wyatt will be on strike.
What I really like this... about this from Tash Farrant is she's looking to score. Although she's number 11 in England, are in a bit of strife, she's looking to score runs. She's not just blocking it out and waiting for the next over so Wyatt's on strike. She's actively looking to get her on strike.
And we know what Wyatt can do because we saw that big six, and New Zealand have elected to keep mid on and mid off up inside the circle, encouraging that big shot from Danielle Wyatt. As Tahuhu is in, Wyatt defends, wants a single. It isn't there. We've already seen one truly calamitous run out during this innings. Another would not be useful. There's a young supporter down there, and by young I mean sort of a few months old, wearing a wide brimmed hat.
Oh yes, I've spotted.
There's two of them actually, one in a very fetching spotty hat.
I like a wide brimmed hat.
You don't wear one in the field though?
No, my head's too small. It flops off.
Tahuhu bowling to Wyatt, pushed into the offside. A single is taken. 165 for 9. Well, you don't want that. But surely you could get a tighter one.
No, so during the 100, there was small, medium, 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 large, and extra large. But I needed an extra small.
Yeah, I can see what you're saying. Tahuhu bowling to Farrant, pulls the ball away again down towards long leg, where a single will be taken. Kasparic will pick up, and there is one taken. England 166 for 9. Well, I know the feeling, and they just didn't supply one.
No, they didn't, but that's all right. I've fed it back, and hopefully next year I can have my wide-brimmed hat.
Well, I hope so, because I think you'd really, you'd rock that on the outfield.
Or you get one with a little string you can tie it around your neck.
Played firmly into the offside by Danny Wyatt, and there is no run. It's stopped by Susie Bates at mid-off. England 166 for 9. I can imagine that, but I'm not sure the sort of string under the chin.
Whilst you're trying to field a ball.
Yeah.
It's a hazard, isn't it?
Because sometimes you do see fielders that sort of lose their hat as they're running, and it all just gets chaotic. So to Wyatt, who ducks out of the way of a delivery that goes at about knee height past the off stump. In a rather unusual way of leaving a ball, but, you know.
I think she was expecting the bouncer.
Yeah, almost.
The double bluff from Tahuhu, yeah. Who's got a big smile on her face.
38 overs gone, England 166 for 9. I'll go through that scorecard because it makes a reasonably bleak reading for England. The top of the order, Lauren Winfield-Hill played really nicely before being involved in that run-out. That was with Danny White. She made 39. Beaumont 12, 18 for Heather Knight, then scores of 1 for both Nat Siver and Amy Jones. Sophia Dunkley made 11, Charlie Dean 8, Sophie Eccleston 4 and Kate Cross 1. The unbeaten pair, Wyatt on 45 and Farrant on 11.
My food's nearly here.
Oh, I've got no sympathy, Alex.
Amber's going to go for
is
me.
Is she?
Yes.
That is very kind. Round the wicket, Roe bowls to Farrant, forward very correctly into the offside, and it's stopped. Why on earth did you put an order in just before you were about to go on the radio?
You told me it was a good idea.
No, I said it'd be a better idea than standing in the queue that was really long.
Just the timings just haven't worked well, have they? You know. But these things happen because somebody blamed me for missing a commentary stint, which wasn't my fault, so I got pushed back a little bit.
Don't look at me. That was Westbury. Roe, round the wicket. Left alone by Farrant, and it's wide enough. That gentleman signals wide again.
He loves a wide, doesn't he?
He does.
He's got a Birmingham Phoenix hat on as well.
Yeah, you've seen quite a few of the 100 merchandise doing the round. There's somebody in a Hannah Rowe shirt down there as well. New Zealand fan.
She's got a no balls bottle. Drinks bottle.
Does she?
Yes.
The cricket podcast that you and Kate Cross do on BBC Sounds. 167 for 9. Rowe round the wicket to bowl to Farrant. Beats the outside edge through to Katie Martin. Brooding clouds over the cathedral to our left. And England in a spot of bother. We're into the 39th over of this innings. If England, if these two can bat through to 45 overs, that'll be a job pretty well done.
Yeah, it will. It will. And especially while Danny Wyatt's still at the crease, she's looking to score runs. It's just when does she take that risk?
Rowe bowling to Farrant, who's played as well as anyone actually in this innings, pushes forward into the offside, but there's no run.
She's a good batter, is Tash Farrant. Her batting's come on leaps and bounds over the last 2 years or so. She worked really hard, fielding as well. Used to be a fine leg fielder and used to try and stay out of the way, but now you could have her anywhere in the field. She's worked so hard on her cricket game.
She's on strike now. As Rowe is in, it's aerial and just, I think, out of the reach of the field. There may have been a hand on it. Might go down as a chance that. It went towards cover. And toughish chance, but...
Oh, poor effort, though. There was no dive. They just stuck a mitt out and was hoping for the best.
Maddie Green it was, who was waiting. And an expansive stroke from Tash Farrant that brings a couple of runs. And England 169 for 9. I can sense you're on edge, Alex. Rowe, bowling to Farrant, left alone, very wide. Oh, there he goes again.
Loves a wide. He loves a wide, does our mate in the black cap.
Well, I'm not surprised that the seats are empty either side of him, because people are probably sick of having sort of the wide signal slapped into their ears.
16 in wides today so far.
I've got it to the main road. Will you turn my mic back on?
For goodness sake. Honestly. Rowe, into bowl to Farrant, who is feeling for one outside the off stump. That wasn't a particularly controlled shot through to the keeper.
Alex Hartley, who was the last left-hander to bat for England in an ODI?
Lydia Greenway.
Very good. And what was the year?
2016.
Yes, yeah, the first time in 5 years we've seen a left-hander batting for England women in an ODI.
That is remarkable. In comes Rowe. round the wicket to bowl to Farrant, driving. Nice piece of timing out to deep cover. Single taken. She moves to 14. England 171 for 9.
Do you know what is also remarkable? That I knew that that quickly.
Yeah, I was going to say, that's almost like you two set that up.
No, I just know my stuff, Henry.
You do. End of the over. 39 have gone. 171 for 9 is the England score. 3 for 26 for Rowe, who's been outstanding today. A couple of wickets apiece for Casper and Devine as well. And England looking to try and find a sort of total that they might be able to defend. I mean, what would be realistically something they would feel?
I think the Wyatt and Farrant here will be talking about small targets. So can we get up to 180, 190, 200? But realistically, you've still got 11 overs to bat. You want to get up to 230, 240. But they'll be targeting that 200 first and foremost.
Yeah. 230, still 60 away or 59 away. It's a long...
It is a long way, and only one wicket to go for New Zealand.
And Tahuhu is going to continue from the Diglis end, roaring in the long sleeves to bowl to the left-handed Farrant, who plays the ball correctly out towards backward point. There is no run.
Yeah, as a number 11 myself, in situations like this, and you're in with a set batter, you just want to get them on strike, but you can't just stick in and just keep blocking the ball and blocking the ball. You have to try and actively look to score and be positive without being reckless.
I'm going to talk about one of your favourite partnerships shortly on that theme. As in comes to Tahuhu, that's nicely played once more, but backward point in position again to stop it. Because you and Natsiva had a 50-run partnership, and I'm not being silly when I say, you know, she got 50 of them.
It was a 46-run partnership.
Was it?
Yeah.
But yeah. She got 46 of them.
Yeah.
But how much of the strike did you have in it?
So we tried to farm the strike. So if Natsiva hit a ball out to deep cover on the first ball of the over, we wouldn't run.
Yeah. Tahuhu in, down the leg side. Was that a chance of a catch? It was chased by Farrant. And it went to the right of Katie Martin. England have run through. And is that going to be signalled as runs?
Yep. She's got a little glove on that through to the keeper, but it's just dropped short of Martin. A life for England, though. They need that. They need all the luck they can get.
I'll have another look at this. Yeah, there is a little tickle on it. It went low. I wonder if that might have been a chance. To Tahuhu again. To bowl to Danny Wyatt, right-hander. Into the leg side it goes, nicely timed. Should be two, perhaps. No, the fielder, Rowe in the deep, picks up and throws. And there is just the one run. So England won 7-3 for 9.
So if Siva hit a ball out to deep cover, first ball of the over, we wouldn't run. But if there was two balls left, we would run. Because she would trust me that I would be able to survive for one or two balls.
Okay, so you know, proper tail end of partnership stuff.
Yeah, just... So that you farm the strike, and then she selfishly left me 50 shy of my maiden ODI 50.
Brutal.
Getting out LBW, playing across the line. Come on, Siva.
So you shook your head walking off, thinking what might have been. Tahuhu, round the wicket to bowl to Farrant. Drops it short, played into the offside, and there's no run. Phil, you're poised.
Yeah, I was poised, yeah. England were in that game 119 for 9 when Hartley strode to the wicket. You faced 17 balls for that naught not out before Nat Siva was so selfishly out.
That was always something that I back myself to do, block it and not get out. It's scoring the runs I find hard.
Tahuhu bowling to Farrant as a peel for LBW. Umpire Anna Harris shakes her head in the distance, and it is the end of an over where England have survived once again, 173 for 9.
Yeah, in the end, that partnership was worth 42. England got up to 161. Natsiva was 85 off 109 balls.
Well, you know, without Jack Leach, you don't get the Headingley victory. Ben Stokes scored the runs, but Leach was there to support him, so it's a very important role. But it's worth pointing out, Farrant is doing a good job here. She's got 15 from 20. Wyatt's on 46. England 173 for 9. Alex Hartley, some more from you, and then it'll be Emily Winter.
Yep, Tash Farrant doing a brilliant job here with Danny Wyatt, both, as I keep saying, looking to score runs. Tash Farrant actually bats in the middle order when she plays domestic cricket, so yes, she's number 11 here for England, but she is no rabbit. You often see genuine number 11s and not genuine number 11s. You know, I'm a genuine number 11. Tash Farrant is probably not.
No, I sort of said off air, Tash coming in at 11 is not a bad option. I think she's a good character as well. She likes the tough situations. Then the ball later, she hit a 4. In comes Hannah Rowe to Wyatt, and that's hit hard over extra cover. What a shot that is from Wyatt. The fielder comes round at cover and can do nothing about it. That is four for Danny Wyatt, and that is her 50. That is a fantastic knock.
It really is. And in the situation that she's been batting as well, she's been absolutely fantastic. She's only faced 63 deliveries as well for that 50. Taking a risk there, moving her feet to the seamer, coming down the track to hit the ball up and over extra cover. Yes, it's a shot she loves and a shot she plays so well, but she's not frightened of this situation in England being nine down.
The England dressing room came out to the balcony to our right to applaud that 50 from Danny Wyatt, going back into this ODI side and really making a mark. As in comes Rowe to Wyatt, this time she plays down the ground. Rowe can't stop it, but mid-wicket comes round in the end.
Yeah, 63 balls for that 50 from Danny Wyatt. Four fours, a six. It's the third time she's passed 50 in ODIs, but the first time she's done it on home soil.
And what a situation to do it in as well. When your team need you, when the wicket's been crumbling around her, she's managed to stick around.
In comes Rowe again to Wyatt, who advances, hits down the ground, hits that long as well. I think that'll be six more. Yes, it is. This lively crowd at Worcester on their feet. The grounds of applause for Wyatt there. She moves to 56, 183 for nine.
So good from Danny Wyatt. She backed herself here. She's confident. She knows she's in form. She knows she's scoring runs. And she's decided now's the time that we're going to kick on. This is the bowler I'm going to target. Shuffles her feet. Gets to the pitch of the ball, over mid off for six. What a shot.
Gave the Worcestershire crowd something to cheer about as well.
Got a good crowd today. Really good crowd.
Yeah, very good crowd. It was sad to see about the queues on social media, people waiting 40 minutes to come in, but it's worth the wait now. As Rowe in again, hit hard down the ground again to mid off. She's now sitting on the circle, so comes through for a single. Wyatt to 57. 184 for nine now, England.
It's good that from Danny Wyatt as well. Hits her for six over her head and then just plays nicely down the ground for a single. Tash Farrett only has two balls to survive before it's the end of the over.
Yeah, and Tash has played some lovely shots as well. Very interesting field here. Almost 2 points of really short point in place as Rowe in, and that's a play. Miss, that's a nick outside the off stump, and that'll be four more to the total. Martin can't do anything about that. Farron will move to 19, 188 for nine.
Well, England need those runs, they'll take it. Yes, it was a genuine edge from Tash Farron, who's got a little smirk on her face. Four more to her total, she's up to 19. She's played a really good knock here for England. She was just looking to block that one in front of square. It was wide outside the off stump. A genuine nick for four.
Take them as they come. Cover has gone out to the boundary rope for the final ball of this over. They want Farrant to be facing the majority of deliveries. As Rowe comes in from the pavilion end, bowls, and that's outside the off stump again. She misses this time. That's the end of the over. 188 for nine, and nine overs remain.
There's a fine line here for New Zealand as well of wanting to get the final wicket, wanting to bowl England out for less than 200, but searching for it and trying too hard. You can see they're being very aggressive with their fields. They've got catchers in, they've got people in close. But Tash Farrant can bat. So, you know, she's not somebody that you can have a short leg to or whatever. You need to also respect her and not think that she's not going to score runs, because she is capable of.
And the thing is, as you said, it's a fine balance, isn't it? They can be too aggressive to Farrant, and actually they've got the sweepers up and she gets a couple of boundaries, and all of a sudden they're not just chasing 200, they could be chasing 220.
And that, on, you know, it 20 runs makes a big difference. You know, if you're chasing 280 or 300, you know, 300 feels a lot bigger.
Leah Tahuhu into Wyatt, that's cut away nicely. The cover sweeper may not be able to do anything about that. Yes, she does. Fantastic diving strop to her left, Maddie Green there, but keeps it to two. Wyatt keeps a strike. She moves to 59, 190 for nine.
That was a brilliant shot from Danny Wyatt behind point, and you thought he was four for love no money, but Green, a fantastic full length diving stop, and saves her team two runs.
I'm about to give Alex Hartley some bad news in a moment.
Oh no.
That is really worrying. I'm worried for you.
I know
now,
what
Alex.
It is.
Tahuhu in, and that's a nice run down to third man this time from Wyatt. She moves to 60, 191 for nine.
I know what it is.
OK, to know what it is.
They've gone past mine and Siva's record-breaking partnership, haven't they?
You've been erased.
Honestly.
Yeah, this partnership now worth 45, an England record for the 10th wicket in ODIs, replacing Alex Hartley and Nat Siva's 42 in Mumbai back in 2019.
It's lucky, isn't it? Hartley's got her sunglasses on, as we'll be seeing a little tear run down her face as Tahuhu ran the wicket in to Farrant, just blocks that one. But then there's also a smile as well as her deliveroo arrives to her right.
Amber and Georgia Elwis have been absolute lifesavers for me there.
191 for 9, England. Tash Farrant, number 11 at the crease, 19 off 23. She's played nicely so far, and Danny Wyatt's up the other end. A very impressive 60 off 68 coming back into the side. Batting at number 7, doing a job when her team needed it. It's Tahuhu in. Short delivery pulled into the onside. There's no fielders out there. Again, we're seeing that aggressive option. Will it go all the way? No, it won't. Maddie Green again pulls it in the rope. They think about 3, but Wyatt's happy to settle for 2. And Farrant moves to 21.
Yeah, good option for Wyatt to send Tash Farrant back there. Not go for the third run. Don't want to run out in this situation.
Really important runs, these from Farrant. England now 193 for 9. There's not many fielders outside the circle. Just a third man and a fine leg to Farrant here as Tahuhu round the wicket. That's clipped nicely. There is a fielder there.
Oh.
Satherthwaite, but didn't just carry. 193 for 9.
That was nearly perfect field placing from New Zealand there. The ball being clipped round the corner, a short ball from Tahuhu. Tash Farrant looks to clip it into the leg side. It just falls short at Amy Satterthwaite, who is a catching backward square leg.
Yeah, a very unusual position. We've seen some unusual positions from New Zealand in this series. That was nearly perfect as Tahuhu in again. Forward in defence comfortably by Farrant. That's the end of the over again. 193 for 9. 8 overs remain. This is great batting from these two.
Yeah, they've had a brilliant partnership. Yes, it's erased my record breaking one, but I don't mind that. You want England to get up to a decent total here. They've struggled this afternoon here at Worcester. They haven't had many partnerships, and this one is the most important one of the day.
Certainly is. Lauren Winfield Hill scored a lovely 39 before a mix up between Wyatt and herself. But she's the only one really to have got going. Heather Knight got 18. Otherwise, the batting lineup didn't fire today. But Wyatt coming in at 7. She's here in the middle, 60, not out. Change of bowling from the pavilion end. Jess Kerr coming into the attack to Wyatt now. There's a long off, a long on, a deep cover, and a deep mid wicket. She's got a bowl full here. In she comes then from the pavilion end to Wyatt. That is a full delivery. She's hit that straight down the ground. One bounce to long off will just be a single. Wyatt moves to 61. 194 for 9, England.
Then the field comes in when Tash Farrant comes on strike. They squeeze a little bit. I think they've actually been too aggressive to Tash Farrant and they've leaked important runs. I think if you can just keep the field not necessarily spread, because then it becomes too easy for Farrant to get off strike, but they seem to be forcing the wickets here.
And Farrant hits well square of the wicket, doesn't she? You're going to bring long on and long off up into the circle, but a deep cover, you feel, or a deep square could be an option. As in comes Kerr to Farrant, she's just guided that down to third man. Wyatt says no, there probably was a single there in hindsight, but as you said, don't want to run out. 194 for 9.
Yeah, there's the fine line of being aggressive and wanting to accumulate as many runs as you can, but also you've got to be a bit wary, a bit tentative. Tentative, the right word?
I'd say that's the right word, but Farrant is playing nicely. 21 off 27. In comes Kerr, and that's this time played nicely down to third man. Battle point does come round, but they come through for a single. Farrant doing her job here. She moves to 22. 195 for 9.
Every time Farrant gets off strike, she gets a round of applause from the crowd as well, which I love. I love that.
Yeah, it's great to see so many people here at Worcester. Sun's out, a little bit of cloud overhead. The sun's just shining through and into our eyes here in the commentary box. It's Jess Kerr into Wyatt. That's a wide Yorker length delivery that she misses. That's a good delivery from Kurt.
It is. I think she's gone for the slower ball. Yorker. Wide Yorker. Strange plan, but it was a dot.
Yes, quiet. Just couldn't quite get hold of that one. There's a cover sweeper out on the offside in the long off. But with this field, Kerr has to bowl full. You're going to want to be bowling fuller and shorter. In comes Kerr again to Wyatt. That is shorter delivery. Wyatt just mistimes it out to the square leg sweeper. 196 for 9. And that's the 50 partnership between Danny Wyatt and Tash Barrett.
A brilliant partnership as well. They've batted superbly together. Tash Barrett came in, looked to score runs from the off. Quite often as a number 11, you can just sit in and just wait for your partner to be on strike, wait for the end of the over, but not Tash Farrant. She's played her shots, she's played beautifully, and this 50-run partnership has been crucial here for England.
Certainly has, as in comes Kerr over the wicket again. Slower delivery and forward in defence by Farrant. Nicely played, and there will be a change in commentary position at the end of the over. 196 for 9. Hartley will be off to get her, eat her delivery. And we'll be joined by Isabel Westbury.
Yeah, 50 partnership for England here for the 10th wicket between Tash Farrant and Danny Wyatt. Just the 7th time, I think it is, that a 50 partnership has been achieved for the 10th wicket in women's ODI history.
Wow, that's a big statement.
Here's a question. This is the first 50-run partnership of the whole match. So is that the first time that that's happened?
Thanks, Izzy, yeah. I will have a look. No, I will have a look.
We're giving him some work to do.
And here I was thinking that Alex Hardy had just given me lunch, but no, she's removed her.
Do you know what? It was smelling very nice, so I just was just getting a whiff, so I'm glad she's gone to eat that. It was making me very hungry.
I mean, I've got an important question I'm going to ask you in a minute.
Oh no, it's Kasprick into Wyatt. Shorter delivery, turned nicely into the onside. They're going to think about two here. I think she's placed that rather nicely. Farrant says no. That's a great bit of work out there from Rowe. Just one to the total. Wyatt 63, 197 for 9.
Have you told our listeners yet that Tash Farrant is an underrated batter?
Well, I sort of mentioned it when I first came on air, but...
Because I feel as though I'm going to stand up for you here. Because when she walked to the crease, you said that passing comment. You said, I think Tash Farrant's underrated. I think she's a great batter.
And here she is, 22 not out.
And you didn't say anything because you were worried that she'd get out.
Kasprick into Farrant, and that's played nicely into the offside, but will be no run. Yeah, I've seen her play. Obviously, the Vipers played the Stars, Southeast Stars, in the domestic stuff quite a lot. They were in our league last year, and I've seen her score some crucial innings with the bat, and she certainly can hit 360. She's got sweeps, reverse sweeps, but she hasn't need to play those yet. There's Kasprick in. She uses her feet, hits down the ground. This could be caught. Yes, it is, on the second attempt. And England, 197 all out. That was a fantastic partnership, though, between Farrant and Wyatt. Wyatt will be not out, 63 of 72 deliveries, but Farrant gone, 22.
Oh, I think I lasted two balls there of my commentary stint. Not that that matters, really. But that was beautiful to watch. I really enjoyed that. I think you're absolutely right. Tash Farrant is an underrated batter. As I think you can always argue that England do bat, that they genuinely do bat all the way down to 11. The problem they've got at the moment is that everyone can chip in and bolster a good innings with a few runs here or there. But what they're really lacking, and we've seen it in the last match, we've seen it again, is some help in that middle order beyond just one person. It was Heather Knight in the first match. It's Danny Wyatt here to form those partnerships. The fact that that 10th wicket partnership was the first 50-run partnership of the innings is wonderful for these two, but pretty horrendous reflection of England's batting down the line.
And as well, Izzy, I don't know if you want to comment, on the nature of her, some of the dismissals we saw in the middle order. Some of them, you'd say, potentially were soft.
You've touched on sort of something that we all like to dwell on, the anatomy of a batting collapse, and quite often, and I think you're right, I think there were some soft dismissals, but I would also hedge that and say I thought New Zealand, the out balls that they bowled were brilliant, and I say that very pointedly because they also bowled an extraordinary number of extras, which is quite weird. But the deliveries to get England out from Hannah Rowe, from Sophie Devine, if you watch them back on replay, they were good.
And they bolted their plans, actually.
They did
bolt
their plans.
You could see that they had specific plans, different matchups, different bowlers to target
batters. Once again, thank you for getting to New Road
well today.
So your health
credit
and
to New
safety
Zealand,
are our
right,
highest priority. And COVID-19 is still with us, so please take sensible measures to protect yourselves and those around you. Together, we can ensure we all have a safe and enjoyable time at the cricket today.
Stay on to wear the time being on between. The
let me bring you a couple of stats as I can see you looking round there. Tash Farran, 22. It's the joint highest score by an England number 10 in ODIs. You might want to comment on this, Izzy. England have batted first four times in 2021. And for the fourth time in a row, they've been all out without completing their 50 overs.
Yes, that's a really interesting point to make, considering that word that comes back into my head is the comments that we heard from Heather Knight preceding this series with the Ashes in mind coming up over the winter, the ODI World Cup as well, is that she wanted this England team who are full of promise, who have performed very, very well under her leadership, along with Lisa Kightley, the head coach. She wanted them to be ruthless. And so far, I don't think we've seen that, and that will frustrate Heather. I think it will frustrate many viewers as well. This is a five-match series. Her England at the moment is still going to Pakistan as well to play some ODIs over there. So there's time, but considering the sort of the effort they put into it, the amount of cricket that they played, you'd want to see it materialising a bit sooner than that.
Yep, hi, Izzy.
Hello.
Back again. I'll be with you for the interval as well. You're going to stay with us throughout the interval too. But yeah, it's the ruthlessness that's got to be there. They've been rescued somewhat. Will 197 be enough? Can New Zealand overhaul 198? The bowlers are going to have to bowl out of their skin, you'd imagine. A word on Danny Wyatt, because that half century stand with Tash Farran is what has rescued England, but 63 not out. It sort of seems quite scarcely believable that when you look at her numbers, and for someone who's played for England for so long, she hasn't been ever present. That's the whole point, I suppose. But 77 one day international, which is only before today, past 50 twice, 150 and 100. And she has, as we know, been up and down the order in the one-day side.
Yeah.
I suppose today, I mean, she came in the 28th over and so had actually all these overs to play to actually compile a score.
I think it's something we touched upon earlier in commentary, was that it's a sort of chicken and egg situation, is in that has Danny Wyatt not performed because she's been shafted up and down the batting lineup, or has she been shafted up and down the batting lineup because she hasn't performed? And I think it's probably a bit of both. And there have been times when she's been dropped and given very specific instructions to, you know, to knuckle down on this area or that, or where you might bat. But I think, I remember writing about Danny White in 2015 about how she'd be treated in that in the England setup, and you feel as though it's rather remained. I mean, maybe she hasn't helped her cause. You could argue that as well. But I think that the sort of net outcome of that is that it does seem remarkable that this is her first 50 in an ODI career that has spanned 11 years.